Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are, and welcome to Fantasy Island. And as a wise man once said on a TV show, as we had a little glitch there in the Matrix for a couple seconds, Miss Robin.
Yes, we did.
And people thought, wait, are you running a best of? Did you guys mail it in today? No,
no,
you know what we're doing, Robin.
We'll do it live.
We're doing it live. No.
We'll do it live. Do it live. I'll write it and we'll do it live. And things
sucks. Yes.
Now, you were sick last week, and somehow or another, it defaulted to a previous schedule where you were not on because of that, even though it's stated in the schedule, or schedule, as they say.
Schedule.
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 That's, we're supposed to be live, so I had to quickly...
We're live.
Think on my feet there.
Local and late breaking. It is the station of the people. It is the Tony Bruno Show, and I'm wearing my Play Gloria t-shirt today. And I was wondering, you know, should I get rid of this shirt? And it has a real important reason today and a meaning
yes.
today. We'll talk about that. One of the best stories you'll ever hear. And we were happy to be a part of it. Not to help as far as what happened, but to be a part of what transpired back in 2019 when we were living in Philly. And there was this unbelievable story developing in St. Louis, Missouri. But we were in Philadelphia watching the St. Louis Blues. So it's an amazing story. We'll have the happy results on this show today. We got March Madness going on. And yes, Virginia, the Cavaliers suck. Let's be honest, ladies and gentlemen. The first four fiasco is finally out of the way. Unwatchable. And I got to give it up to my boy on CBS Sports. The guy, remember, he was a pretty good player. I think he played in Maryland, right? Let's go to last night, Robin. This is after the two games were played and the supposed good game, the one involving teams that were supposed to be good, you know, teams that were playing for a 10 seed instead of a 16 seed. They went out there and put on a basketball. I mean, I can't explain it as well as Wally Szczerbiak and the guys at CBS last night having to talk about perhaps the worst basketball game ever played in the NCAA tournament. Let's go to the tape.
This performance matters by Virginia. I mean, Mountain West completely blew them off the floor. Mountain West, we've been saying, has been completely underseeded. And the way you perform in this tournament, it puts the committee on notice. They made a mistake putting Virginia into the NCAA tournament. Every bracketologist was saying it. They go out and play like this. It's unwatchable basketball the way they played today on national TV. St. John's is sitting there like, we've won 6 out of 7. We're scoring 90 points a game, playing great basketball down the stretch in the Big East. Seton Hall beat Marquette and UConn. They're sitting at home or in the NIT. They should be in this NCAA tournament. Pitt should be in this NCAA tournament.
Or Oklahoma.
Also,
Oklahoma,
the committee made a big mistake by putting this team in the NCAA tournament this year. And it's nothing against Tony Bennett. He's a great national championship winning coach. But his team did not belong on this floor with Colorado State.
Team and teams, four of the last times that they played the NCAA tournament, they have lost in the first round of double-digit seeds.
Yep.
So there's a point, there's a question of whether Virginia basketball, the way they play, maybe it's outdated.
Yep.
Yeah. Maybe it's outdated.
No question.
You know?
No question.
Yeah. All right. Well,
they stunk on ice.
This
and Wally Szczerbiak, by the way.
By Virginia.
Yeah, you could turn that. Wally Szczerbiak, I was wrong. I mean, obviously, he played at the U, Miami University. Did you know that Wally Szczerbiak grew up in Spain, Robin? He was born in Spain.
I did not
yes.
know that.
Yes, indeed. Wally Szczerbiak, a great analyst now.
Spaniard.
He was doing the New York Knicks for a while. I don't know if he's still doing it, but on MSG Network. But he's very solid on television. And he basically spit game last night, and it was unwatchable. And how many times do I say, have I used the word unwatchable in sports, Robin? Not very awesome. Like, not very often. But I know one thing. I always talk about the college football bowl season, that week between Christmas and New Year's,
mm-hmm.
when everybody's sitting at home, the weather sucks in many parts of the country, and then guys like Harry Mays... I don't want to name names here. Nick Cale, Harry Mays, and other degenerate gamblers sit at home mm-hmm. watching and betting on unwatchable, meaningless college football during that bowl week. You know, the fringe bowls. I'm not talking the big ones. There's only like four or five that really matter. The rest are just filler programming. I would rather watch one of those, what are the things that they put? I want an EBS test, a test of the emergency broadcasting system on a loop, or just a screen that they used to put up at 2 o'clock in the morning when television stations signed off the air, and they would put the test pattern up there. I'd rather watch a test pattern. And anybody who watched that game, and I tried to watch it, but I could not stomach it. It's unbelievable. And thank you, Don Wallace, yes, for the Wally Zerbiak update, man. Didn't Wally have the big, was he one of the guys who had the arm tats back in the day when he played? I don't think he was guy. Who was the guy with the, like, all of the tats that were looked, remember they had the thing that looked like barbed wire? Remember that was a big thing for a while? I don't think Wally Zerbiak, well, he's Spanish, though. Maybe they did that when he back in Madrid. And he's right. Virginia sucks. And by the way, I'm going to play this for Tony. He mentioned Tony Bennett. Tony Bennett, the head coach of Virginia, obviously has been a successful coach. But it made me think about another Tony Bennett, Robin. The Tony Bennett, who's no longer with us, but is one of the all-time greats. The original TB. Not Tony Bruno, not Tom Brady, not Terry Bradshaw, but Tony Bennett. Crank it up a little for me, Robin.
I left my playbook
in downtown Charlottesville, where there were no fine people on either side. And they called to you to be where shitty basketball is played by the Virginia Cavaliers.
Oh, this is going to be a hit, Tony. This is a hit.
I'm winging this. I don't have a script here, Robin. I'm going a cappella here, whatever he has. Yeah, it was Chris Anderson. A bunch of guys had these sleeves. Yeah, and Colorado State, they're a good team. Colorado's a good team. They're playing tonight, so I had to play a little Tony Bennett. And Tony Bennett. I mean, Stephen A. Smith was calling for Tony Bennett to get fired today.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, come on, man. Wally Zerbiak, man. Guy's smooth. You could tell he's not like a metagon. You know what I mean?
And he's a good-looking man.
Yes, he is, Robin. I could say so. I have no shame. I mean, I'm a heterosexual male, but there's nothing wrong with admiring a sculptured man like Wally Zerbiak.
Well, I think that we all know, Tony, that you have no shame. I mean, that's...
What do you mean?
That goes without
saying. It's not about shame.
No. I mean, I'm agreeing with you here.
Anyway, so that's what happened last night. But we got March Madness today, Robin. And you know there's one guy I always love putting on when it's anything collegiately, not the college girls, because you know what they say about those college girls, Robin. We keep getting older, and they stay the same age, man. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So anyway, we got action tonight.
Uh-huh.
Two more of the first four in. We got two in last night. Colorado State played great last night. And now they move on and start to play in the big dance, the first round. So Colorado State will play the 7-seed Texas on Thursday in Charlotte, North Carolina. And then we'll have a couple of other brackets. Grambling State tonight. First appearance in the dance in a long time ever, I think. And they're playing Montana State tonight. And then Colorado will be playing Boise State in the second game tonight. And I have some interesting stats on those games, and we will release the second four, the first four, part two. Shouldn't that be the second two, if not the first four? Because when you have the first four, and four is always the number that matters on the show, as you know, Rob.
Yes, yes.
But if you played the first two of the first four last night, shouldn't it be the last two of the first four? You following me, Robin?
I think so.
Anyway, we'll get it back to this. We got a lot of college basketball to talk about. And Indiana State, another team that was snubbed, and we talked about it. Listen, you don't even have to be a college football guru. You didn't have to be Palm. One guy, not Jerry Palm. He's a different guy. There's another guy named Palm, and then there's the guy, Matt, what's his name? Joe Lenardi at ESPN. Mm-hmm. These guys spend 24 hours a day when college basketball season starts to the very end, racking their brains and trying to figure out which team should be in and which team should be out and which team's on the bubble. And with all due respect to those guys, because they know their shit, they realized that Virginia, and everybody was saying this on Sunday, how the hell did Virginia get in? How the hell did St. John's not get in? And I'm telling you, if Rick Pitino doesn't go apoplectic today after watching Virginia, if Indiana State and our great player, our good friend who we'll get to see tonight, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, will be back in action
our
tonight.
Our favorite name.
Your boy in the house out there in Terre Haute, Indiana tonight. Yes, indeed, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, indeed. My boy will have the goggles on tonight in Indiana State. That could be my lock of the night, Robin. I will release those later on this very broadcast.
Tony, we have a quick little message here from the fabulous Rick Calhoun, who is one of our partners with Naples
Wealth. We love Rick Calhoun.
With Naples Wealth Planning. And he just texted and he said, there are dogs running out for cover all over Southwest Florida as Tony is singing.
Listen, I may be Italian and I may have a lovely speaking voice, but that doesn't mean I can sing. I've never said I could. Now, I do some of my best work at karaoke after about five vodka crans.
Yes, you do.
And by the way, everybody who goes to karaoke and has whatever the particular drink that you enjoy.
Well, here's the trick about karaoke. It's not just the singer that needs to be drinking. It's everybody in the audience that should be drinking, because then everybody sounds great.
No, we don't want people day drinking, Robin. Save that for tomorrow when the tournament starts at 10 o'clock
karaoke,
in the morning on the West Coast at noon, just after noon here on the East.
If you're doing karaoke, everybody should be have had at least four or five drinks, because then the night is so much nicer.
Trust me, there'll be a lot of beverages poured over the next couple of weeks as the NCAA big dance is underway, baby. NIT tonight, bunch of games. We'll break them all down for you. I have all the numbers. I have all the research. I have all the stats. I have everything you'll need to know. And, of course, the great Tim Brando. Not related to Brian Bruno or Tony Bruno. It's Tim Brando down at the Chateau again.
Yes.
Now that his portion of the college basketball play-by-play action on Fox Sports and the Pac-12 in their swan song in the tournament. And speaking to Pac-12, Colorado tonight, our Pac-12 team, and the Pac-12's done well in the tournament. Boise State, meanwhile, I gave the stat a little earlier. Boise State, you know, they have the Smurf turf in football. And they're favored tonight. No, Colorado's favored by 3.5, and they should be. But Colorado, 24-10, Boise State, 22-10, two pretty good teams. But Colorado and the Pac-12 have been dominant, especially against Mountain West teams. So we'll see whether that plays out tonight. Those are the two other games, Grambling and Montana State. And those are two 16 seeds trying to move into the tournament first round with a victory tonight. So we got St. Joe's and Seton Hall tonight. We got Indiana State, I mentioned, against SMU up there in Terre Haute, Indiana. And that place should be packed. I know the Indiana State fans were outraged, and they should be, especially after what happened with Virginia. I know St. John's fans are outraged. They're not playing in the NIT. They said, screw it. But Seton Hall, one of the teams in the Big East that certainly got shafted. And we'll see how their kids play tonight. You know, because they're playing at home against the St. Joe Hawks from Philly. And, you know, St. Joe's is 3-9 on the road, and Seton Hall is an 8.5-point favorite. You would think Seton Hall, if their kids are jacked up and ready to play in a tournament that many people think is, you know, just another also-ran, time-filling tournament. It used to be the best tournament, and then the NCAA came in. But the NIT was always the best. And now a lot of kids were talking about, well, should the kids go and play in a game like this or play in a tournament like this? And we'll find out the answer tonight. You know, St. Joe's wasn't supposed to be there. Seton Hall should have been in the NCAA tournament, just like Providence. But Seton Hall got screwed, and now we'll see how they show up tonight. Indiana State got screwed, and now they're at home, and they're 7.5-point favorites over SMU. So we will see whether these teams and the rest of the field tonight, for example, you have Princeton at home up at the Jadwin Gym, baby! They're favored over UNLV tonight. And, of course, the good thing about the NIT is they play their games you know, the home team plays their game and the favorite team plays their game at home. So Princeton will play at home against UNLV. Wake Forest will play at home in Winston-Salem tonight against Appalachian State. Wake, an 8.5-point favorite in that game. That's an 8 o'clock game. Well, most of these games start at 8 o'clock on, like, ESPN Plus. How many plus channels do they have? Now, listen, I have no problem with, like, plus-size models, but I don't have ESPN Plus. So how the hell am I going to watch all these games? For example, St. Joe's, Seton Hall. That game gets underway at the Prudential Center in Newark, New Jersey tonight. That game is 7 o'clock on ESPN2. Okay, so that game will be on ESPN2 and ESPN Plus from the Prudential Center in Newark, New Jersey. And then, of course, I mentioned the Holman Center in Terre Haute, Indiana. Indiana State, SMU, that's a 7 o'clock start. That's on ESPN Plus. Bradley taking on Loyola of Chicago, and that'll be at the Carver Arena in Peoria, Illinois. And then the later games I mentioned, Princeton against UNLV, Wake, Cincinnati and San Francisco later on tonight. Well, actually, it's in Cincinnati. That's a 9 o'clock start, even though they're playing in the first third arena. You know, we have the first third bank here.
Yes,
and
we
I
do.
Still don't can't understand why it's called the first third bank in Cincinnati, Ohio.
It was the first bank on 3rd Street.
Is that what it was?
Mm-hmm.
Is that like the house at the end of the street? One
I
of my favorite
so.
Elton John songs.
Yes.
What a great song that was. Underrated. We may have to play it later on. Cincinnati at home, 7.5-point favorites over the Dons from San Francisco. And they had a pretty good year, San Francisco. Not the Doms. They play in another division out there in the I think they play in the Castro, or do they play in the Tenderloin?
I don't know.
Where do the San Francisco Doms play? Wherever they want.
Yeah, wherever they want.
All right,
want.
Wherever you want to play, you can go down to Union Square in San Francisco. You can go down to the Tenderloin, to the Castro. What other districts can they go to, Robin? You're a big San Francisco. We're both San Francisco treats. We love it.
There's the what other districts are there?
I gave you the top three.
I know, the top three. Philadelphia Public School checking in. You don't get this NIT knowledge.
Hell no.
Else.
You know what NIT stands for? The not important tournament. That's why we're breaking it down for you today. No, listen, I'm interested to see how these kids play. Because especially teams that got shafted.
Yes.
Will the kids show up and say, you know what? Yeah, we didn't want to be here. Or are they going to mail it in? Virginia, I guess, wanted to be there until they got out and the game started. I mean, Virginia proved that all of these people who figure out who should be in and who should be out, the first four in, the first five out, you put your left foot in and you shake it all about, you do the hokey pokey and you say this is bullshit. That's what it's all about, ladies and gentlemen. It is Van Ness, that area. Listen, we know the entire San Francisco Bay. South of Market, SOMA, as we call it.
Chinatown District.
And the Italian, where's the Italian area up there, Robin?
Do they have an Italian
yes!
area?
Yes! Are you serious, Robin?
But they're not all called districts, though, are
no,
they?
No, no, no. But there's great Italian restaurants in San Francisco. What's the matter with you? Now, of course, Restaurant di Umbria
is
no
sadly
longer there.
No longer there.
It should be there. And it's still sitting there. They forced our guy, Mr. Giulio Tempesta, who was the man who ran that establishment for
South
all those
Market.
Years. And he was the mayor of South of Market. Mr. Tempesta.
Yes.
And then, you know, they jacked his lease up and he left. And guess what? That building is still empty.
Still empty.
And it's not far from the ballpark where the San Francisco Gigante will start playing baseball. Speaking of baseball, the Soul Series, not the Soul Train. Baseball is underway. Do you realize the baseball season has started, Robin?
It has started.
In Seoul, baby.
Let's play ball.
Play ball now. Let's play ball now. And Shohei Ohtani-san went up there, grabbed a bat in his first game as a Dodger that counted. Because remember, these games count. They're playing in Seoul. So you got the San Diego Padres and you got the Dodgers. And obviously, there were a lot of Dodger fans. You know, because there's Japanese players and Korean players. And they're playing in the Korean stadium. But if you think the Tampa Bay Rays stadium is not really a baseball stadium, and people have said that for decades. Did you see the stadium they were playing in Seoul, Korea? It's not really a baseball stadium. But remember, when there was the pandemic back in 2020, They were playing Korean baseball. They were airing those games on ESPN because they had no other baseball to show while they were still playing in South Korea. So I want to play a clip because, you know, this is an important game. I have the video. I sent you a video of the Los Angeles Dodgers opening day Korea. Two ex-New York Yankee relievers helped the Padres shit the bed. Wande Peralta and Johnny Brito, who, of course, were given up in that huge trade to get Juan Soto from San Diego to go to the New York Yankees. Those guys went in. They were trailing by a run, the Dodgers. But the Dodgers scored four runs. Now, did you find it, Robin?
You didn't send it to
me. I thought I sent it to you. You can find, if you find it, because one of the shots that, one of the great videos of Shohei Ohtani is when he hit a ball so high up. It hit the, because they have all this superstructure up there. In Tampa, they've got that one ceiling that starts low and then goes up to the outfield. And so many players have hit the scoreboard, have hit the runways, whatever they call those things up in top. Well, Robin's got, Robin's on a dress down bad fashion day wearing a hoodie. Steve, how dare you, Steve?
What do you mean I'm not wearing a... I mean,
she's
it's
wearing
not
a Mickey
on.
Mouse hoodie.
It's
We're not going to go and carjack somebody here in Florida. I leave that to Detroit and Philadelphia and the other cities where carjacking is an hourly thing. We don't play that down here.
I see the first hit. Let me see if I find the
Get
one.
This Shohei Ohtani-san. Because he had two hits today. He knocked in a run. And the other guy who's pretty good, Mookie Betts. Remember him, Red Sox fan? So Mookie Betts, Shohei Ohtani, both had two hits each. And Ohtani-san had the people going bananas, man. There's no doubt about it. Whether you hate the Dodgers or not, the Dodgers are now the marquee franchise. And I know the Braves. I'm not saying that there aren't other great teams. I mean, the Phillies are good. Obviously, the Dodgers are great. Obviously, the Yankees, who are banged up now, and now they're worried about what the hell they're going to do. The Giants just got Blake Snell the other day. And still, there's a lot of people out there unsigned.
So this was Shohei hitting it out of the roof.
Not out of the roof.
He hit the roof. But not for the Dodgers. It was when he was playing for the other team.
No, this is him with the Dodgers last night in Seoul time. This is game one. It's actually technically today. In America when that game was played, but obviously there's a time difference.
It was a foul ball. Okay, I got it.
Yeah. He hit the ball. Right. He hit the ball real hard. He hit the fucking ball real hard, as Sammy Sosa would say.
I found it.
Now play that damn thing right now. Let's see a little Shohei Ohtani-san. Now see all the structures up there? Now here's
right into the lefty.
It is hard. Look at all that superstructure up.
Hit the roof in foul territory.
Look at the Dodger fan.
That's his wife.
Is that his wife?
That's his wife playing.
Watch it again. Two-seamer. Boom. And that ball is high. It is high. It is far. It is off the superstructure.
19.2 miles per hour off the bat.
That was awesome, man.
19.2.
If you're scoring at home and if you have a jugs gun at home, why aren't you playing with the jugs instead of the gun? You know what I mean, Robin? I mean, it is What Up Wednesday, after all. So anyway, that's Ohtani. And then this is the weird part of this game. You don't see this very often. So the Padres obviously were leaking in this game. They had a lead, and then the pitching went in, but the Dodgers scored four runs in one inning. How many runs, Robin? And that's the number. Again, it's the number. Forget about Pi Day. It's always four day. Four day, Robin. You get it? There it is. And I had all my notes here on the Dodgers here. I got so many notes today. I got paper everywhere. This is the kind of preparation you don't get on other shows. Guys just walk in, sit down, and then they just start talking shit. This is a well-oiled machine, Robin. And let's go to a man. Are we going to take a break? Yeah, because I don't want to cut Dean off, although I'll cut him off as soon as I put him on. But we'll go to Dean. We'll take your calls. You know the numbers, right? 352-234-8669. Did you write it down? 3-2-4. 3-5-2. Oh, I'm sorry. 3-2-1. That's what it should be. Because you know when you count down, you're doing a commercial, you gotta cut a promo.
It would be good if it were
3-2-1.
No.
Hi everybody.
Take two. 352-234-8669.
Get that thing tattooed right here on your wrist, maybe in your inner lip.
No, don't get it tattooed.
Get
just it tattooed
in your inner lip, though, so nobody will see it. All right?
At some point, we're going to have our very, very permanent, completely, totally permanent tattooable number. But
yeah,
I don't know
that's
this
what they always say, yeah. Robin. That's what they always say. We'll get a number, and then people will call us. The last person who had that number, he'll start getting calls from people that he owed money to, and they'll be calling us saying, is Joe Blow there? I hate that stuff, Robin. We need more extensions. Not hair extensions. They get ripped out if you go out and
when
stuff.
When we come back, we have breaking news, too.
Breaking news? Yes, it is. Plus, we'll have the latest dumbass craze for the young kids out there. We'll have a Jim Harbaugh yard sale update.
I'll tell you why I shouldn't have cut my hair.
And yes, and we'll have the happiest country on earth update. We got a lot of stuff today, and it's a one-up Wednesday. Tony, Bruno, Miss Robin, the whole gang, we're just getting started. We're living on a prayer. We're halfway there. No, we're not even halfway there. We're not even, like, what, one-fourth of the way. Let's see. 3 hours divided by, where would we be?
Give it up, Tony.
If it's 3 hours and we're a half hour in and we have 2.5 hours left, I'm not good at fractions.
We're one-sixth.
One-sixth of the way in, ladies and gentlemen. Stick around. You don't want to miss the thrilling conclusion.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports
on
Network.
On Paramount Mountain, the stakes get higher.
I mean, I can't get that thing up there. If it were a football, I'd be able to reach the top.
What about a football-shaped head? We throw the child.
Gutsy call, sir.
Smart thinking.
What? No, that's dumb thinking. He's not throwing Arnold.
Throw him.
Throw him. Hey, do you want an immunity idol?
Throw him. A what? You can't throw a child at a wall.
Lattimore, shut your face.
Shut my face.
Unless you prefer to freeze to death.
I'm not gonna throw a kid.
Not built for the moment, I see. Fine. I'll throw him.
And Creed's here.
Watch and learn.
Dang, he's cool.
It's the fifth quarter, and we need a hole-in-one before the seventh inning stretch. Be brave. Hike!
Can you take me higher? To the place where the lineman see.
I just threw him higher.
Come on.
To a place where we won't freeze.
He just threw me higher.
Good.
So close.
How are we going to get up there?
Now, if there were only someone made of pigskin.
Bingo.
Oh, dear.
All right. Bring it in. I know it feels like the momentum is shifting, but this game isn't over yet. But coach, the other team keeps getting new AI features. Yeah, they got Circle to Search.
And AI-powered video boost. What?
No way.
Holy
that's
Toledo.
It. We're doomed. That's enough. Sure. Team Pixel got advanced AI to fix group photos. And summarize recordings. And reduce noise in videos. Is there a but? But it doesn't matter what you've got on the inside. It's what's on the outside that counts. Like this season, you dropped 0.67 ounces. You got contoured edges and a different shaped charging port.
Yeah,
oh, just right. Huh. Uh-huh. See, you don't need fancy schmancy AI to edit photos and screen spam calls. Sorry, it's an unknown number.
Ooh.
That's a pickle.
Been there.
Focus. This is our moment. Let's get back out there. And you make sure they remember forever the night they played the team that dared to turn a switch into an action button. Great speech. Thanks for your help, Pixel.
Anything else I can do?
I lost my playbook. Can I borrow yours?
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Some of them want to use you. Some of them want to be used by you. Some of them want to be abused. I've been in pretty much all four of those positions, Robin, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's how you learn.
Hey. Everybody likes something.
I mean,
to each their own.
I get abused on the show every day by the callers and the viewers and the listeners. You get abused. We give each other bump-bump-de-bumps when something goes wrong.
Have you noticed, though, I don't have a bump-bump-de-bump button to give you.
Well, who's holding you back?
I need one.
Well, you control all the horizontal, the vertical, and I control control nothing.
How can I? Can I do this?
Yeah, that's good.
That's a good one.
We need more cowbell.
We need a cowbell. I have a pink cowbell. This is thanks to Big Mama.
Yes, exactly.
Big Mama Radio gave us a pink cowbell. Breaking news.
We have breaking, yes. This is really good breaking news, too. Not bad breaking news.
We want to show you what we received today.
Is it money, cash, lottery tickets, a filled-out bracket with all the winners?
Let's see. I have to actually change this. No, look at this. It's so fresh, it's not even loaded in my computer yet. That, ladies and gentlemen,
is our lot scraped. Scraped clean. You see that baby right there?
That
scraped clean.
We need to, ground has broken.
Technically, it's broken officially now.
Yes.
Now, you see our boat trailer's been moved. Where do they move the boat trailer to, Robin?
I'm not sure where they moved it to, but hold on. I have to show you another picture.
So the scraping of the ground, it's like the swallows returning to San Juan Capistrano.
Can you see there at the bottom?
Yeah.
Right there where
it's all scraped and clean. It's
all scraped and clean.
And I want to thank our buddy who's doing a great job out there, Andy.
Yes.
Because they even fly a drone and give aerial footage to show you the progress.
So exciting.
So I don't have to drive out there every day and say, what's happening? But we drove out yesterday morning, and they had just put up the stakes and they put there's a fence. They put stakes in and then they put the silt.
A silt fence.
Yeah, so if the wind blows, there's not dust going in your neighbor's property and stuff. So
or in the water.
Morning has broken and so has ground. What up, Anthony Madani? 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 Or Madani?
Madani?
Two D's, two N's. Madani.
Madani?
Madone. No,
Madone.
That's a different Madone.
How about Madone?
Madone. Anthony Madone.
I want to thank everybody already who has been doing it so far. Our numbers are looking really great today all over on all the different social media apps. But just as a reminder, if you haven't done it yet, share, retweet, whatever you want to call it on X now, and quote, tweet, and make a comment. Helps our algorithms. And I love it when my algorithms are stimulated.
Yes, indeed.
Let's go to a man who has been on hold for a while.
Well, what else is he going to do? what else has he got to do? He's finished his bathroom project. He's sitting around betting tournaments. How many brackets did you fill out, Dean, up there in Clearwater?
Hold on, Tony. I'm wiping back the tears. Seeing the photos of you a lot brings a tear to my eye, man. That's awesome. I'm so happy for you guys.
Thanks. I am, too. I mean, the fact that our guy, JD, and Andy, but it's called JD.
JT Ventures.
JT, not JT, the Brick Ventures.
No.
Now, a year ago, it's funny because we contacted him a year ago hoping that we would get the permit soon, and then he sent us an estimate for what it would take, to get the lot leveled out. They take off the top coat of all the old dirt and grass and stuff, and then they start bringing in the fill dirt, and then they start compacting it, and then you get the first, they come in and the city tests it and make sure it's okay. Then they bring the blocks in, and then they bring the excavators in to start digging the trench. And that's when it really starts going. When you see, the stem wall built and they start putting the footings in, then you know we've got action, man. And that's exciting. For the first time in over 3 years, we're actually seeing something happen every day. And Dean, you've been out to the lot, and all of our friends and family have been out here. You know, it's exciting. It really is.
Now, the house, like when you're facing the water, the house to your right was like the walls were up. There was nothing, concrete.
It's finished. It's pretty much finished.
Wow. That's awesome.
They did a great job.
So that should give you some perspective on how long you should be up in, right?
Well, we're hoping by Christmas. That would be a merry, merry Christmas. Now, let's see. So we started in March. So you say April 1st, we start getting the dirt compacted, and then we bring in the excavators, and we start getting the concrete.
So like 8 months?
No, I'm saying 9 months. It's like having a baby. Just think right now. Just think of yesterday as the day that, you conceive. You've been planning to have a family, and you take the condoms off, if you want to be safe. But no, if you're married and, you're worrying about, I don't want to have a baby right now, right?
Uh-huh.
So then you use protection. That's what I did when I first got married. You use protection because you don't want to have a kid like the first day.
But we want this baby, so we
are
raw.
I want this baby to come. And I want it to go full term.
This baby's been in somebody for 3 years.
Yeah. We're like having an elephant baby.
Right.
Joe Quills, it will be a Christmas miracle.
Yes, I want to be able to go in there and put a Christmas tree right in the front lawn and light that son of a bitch up. And then have it shoot into space, like the Luxor. You know the light at the Luxor in Las Vegas?
You can see it
from space. I want people to see the Paradiso Bruno from space. I want the space shot, the International Space Station to do a special flyover.
Can we get some of those?
I want the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds to do a flyover.
Can we get one of those spotlights?
Klug lights. Klug lights, right? Aren't they Klug? I think they're Klug lights.
Let's see.
I'm sure you can rent one.
With the spotlights that you go like this,
Klug lights. That's what they're called. Look, Klug.
And then they go like this, and you can see them from everywhere.
Yeah. You think we need one or two? How many Klug lights?
Two. You need to have them crossing like that.
You gotta have two.
One doesn't really work.
Show off. Go with three.
You know what? A Klug light is a carbon arc lamp, typically with a Fresnel lens and a spherical reflector, often used in filmmaking and video production. How about that?
Go.
That's great Klug knowledge right there.
Yes.
You're not getting that on any other show.
No, you're not.
I know my Klug lights.
All right, so back to my phone call.
Okay, yes, let's get it back.
But yeah, you say my bathroom's done. I'm sitting here doing nothing. No, I'm doing something. What do you think I'm doing? What am I doing?
You're filling out your pool, your bracket. You had to have. Now, let me ask you this. Did you have to have those first four games done for your bracket to count? Or if you leave those out, can you still fill out a bracket?
Yeah, no. The guy who runs our pool, as a matter of fact, it's just a tool. My cousin sent me an invite to get in. So, it's just the 64 teams. And, I was listening to you earlier. Bunch of other people as far as people getting shafted and all this stuff. Tony, I don't believe anybody's getting shafted in this tournament. I mean, so when you think
wait a minute, you don't think St. John's or Providence or Seton Hall got shafted in the Big East? The ACC stinks. Tony. The ACC used to be the best basketball conference in America. Now it sucks ass. And that's pretty bad to suck ass, because I've never done it, but I can't imagine doing it. But I know some people do. But hey, whatever floats your boat.
I just don't feel, Tony, right? Because to me, we're talking about the 30th, 40th, 50th, 60th ranked teams here. We're not talking about legitimate teams we're glorifying mediocrity, Tony, when you start talking about the 30th, 40th, 50th team getting shafted. If you go and you look at the history of the NCAA, just take the last 20 or 30 years. I mean, the bottom line is when you get down to the championship, it is always, always North Carolina, a Kansas, a Connecticut, a Louisville, a Duke, a North Florida, a Syracuse, a
Kansas.
State,
I hear what you're saying, but we've seen nobody's picking a 10. No one's picking the 16 seed to win it all. But the point is, if you have all these committees and all these experts, and you heard the Phil Martelli with us yesterday. Phil says, you know, everybody should play in the NIT if they don't make it to the tournament because he believes that helps kids. So there's coaches will feel differently about different things. But to me, I think the guy who really, really nailed it is Rick Pitino. We ripped him when he was goofing on his players. Then they played hard down the stretch. Virginia sucked. Virginia sucked all year. They actually got out to a good start. Did you see what they did? Virginia started out really, really well, and then they shit the bed. And I hate to use that term, but I can't think of a more descriptive term to talk about how that offense. I mean, they had five field goals in the first half. They had 14 points at halftime. They went over an hour of runtime, including the halftime, without scoring a basket. I mean, that's unbelievable.
Tony, it happens.
No, it doesn't. Nobody scores 14 points. I could go a bunch of five-year-olds and go out to a basketball court. They'll score more than 14 points in the first half of a game. Are you serious? Do you tell me a major school like the University of Virginia, a University of Virginia that's won national championships, had unbelievable play. Ralph Sampson probably won't show his face in Charlottesville because of the shame that program's brought to him. Even the four-corner days when North Carolina would run that four-corner offense and hold the ball, you know, and run out the clock. The Princeton offense, when they would, like, drag, you know, and kids standing around and not moving the ball. I mean, it's embarrassing. It's an embarrassment to sports.
You watch how many teams, Tony. You watch how many teams in this tournament. Keep an eye on it. How many teams will go ice cold in the last 5 minutes of a game to get 3 points in the last 5 minutes, or 1 point, that matter? It happens all the time.
Dean,
teams go
they scored 14 points in a half of a major college in a league. These are two teams.
These aren't some small
conference team that's lucky to be there. You know, like look at Grambling State. They haven't been in the tournament. Look at Duquesne. These teams are happy to be there. Nobody's expecting them to win. It's just being in and playing in a meaningful game. That's the beauty. Unlike college football, which has it completely ass backwards, they don't want anybody in the playoff. At least, you know, and we've discussed this, and Tim Brando is going to join us actually at the top of the hour. And I'll ask him, because I can guarantee you, Tim Brando has forgotten more about college basketball, Dean, than you'll ever learn.
Well, that's fine, Tony, but I just don't see, me personally, I just don't see the, it's to me, it's like, you know, when everybody gets into baseball, now into the playoffs, but it used to be you had to win your division. And, you know, now they just glorify giving, I mean, it's good that they're giving more teams and cities chances to win, you know, in baseball, and they expand their playoffs and stuff. But to me, some 18-year-old or 19-year-old kid who's, you know, in the NCAA tournament in the rank 30, 40, or 50, I just think it's just glorifying BS. Because they have no legitimate shot. And the bottom line is, this is what the tournament's for, to tell you, get you a national champion.
Dean,
and
you are so, no you, man, I'm, you're embarrassing yourself today, man. It's not
what
my style.
You know.
You're embarrassing yourself, man.
Why did you say that?
Because a team scored 14 points and a half, and Wally Zerbiak and the guys at CBS have to come on and say, this was unwatchable dreck. But did you think that was watchable?
In the NBA, Tony.
No, but that's the difference. That's not one game. That's not a one and done. You're Virginia. You're not some small. You're not Stetson. You know, Stetson's
in. They had a bad night, Tony.
They didn't have a bad night. They've had a bad stretch. You go back and look at what they've done. I wrote it down here. I just want to point this out to you, Dean.
I find it amazing that you're getting upset over a shit team like Virginia, who wasn't going to win squat, or the team that Virginia was being replaced by, whoever it was, if it was St. Joe's or anybody the other team, they still weren't going to win shit. So
wait a minute.
Matter.
Indiana State was one of the top scoring teams in the country.
And they could have win
that,
squat,
that one
no.
white dude, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, that guy could have scored 14 points by himself in 5 minutes of play. They would have dropped 90 last night.
Dance, Tony, guess what? They'd be exiting the big dance just as fast as Virginia did.
You're full of shit, Dean. I hate to do it to you, man.
No, I'm not.
Oh, yes, you are. You're embarrassing yourself. Even Harry Mays
no,
just called
not.
In and
I'm
said, get him off. Get out. Get out of here.
30th, 40th, 50th ranked team.
Virginia's not the 50th ranked team.
Well,
are you serious?
30th. They're probably 30th.
They won Indiana State won 28 games, Right? You look at the numbers they put up. They were one of the top scoring teams
Tony,
in the country.
But who did they play? That's what the committee takes into evaluation is like their schedule toughness. Who are you playing?
They have the top field goal percentage in the country. I don't care who you're scoring. You score the basketball. You put the ball in the hole. They couldn't put their balls into a damn whorehouse hole. Those guys were embarrassing.
You could score against
Bullshit.
Indiana State.
I could go out there and drop 14 on those idiots at Virginia. Screw Virginia. Screw them.
Exactly, you could.
But I'm not a major college basketball program steeped in history like the Virginia Cavaliers.
Virginia
Come on,
sucks.
Dean.
I agree with you 100%, Tony. But the bottom line is, it doesn't matter. If they didn't get in the bracket, the team that would have replaced them wasn't going to win shit. They might win one game at the most, but that's it. So why are we getting upset over some freaking soft-ass team?
I'm not upset. I'm just saying that you're saying it could happen any night. It doesn't happen any. Nobody scores 50. Little kids, high school kids, elementary school kids score more than 14 points and a half. Jesus. Come on, man.
I sent you my.
Now you got me all worked up. Now I got pains. I got chest pains now.
Oh, you're
not even an hour into the show.
Oh my God.
Not even an hour into the show. I feel like Stephen A. Smith here now, going crazy.
Tony, speaking of 14, did you see my parlay I sent you?
Yes, you almost won what, $92,000?
I said on your show yesterday, because the night before there was only two hockey games, and I said we have a full card. 13 NHL games tonight. I am going to play a 13-team NHL hockey parlay and hit the big mother tonight. And I couldn't believe it. I hit 11 out of 12. I skipped one game. 11 out of 12 for 92 grand. And the stupid Anaheim Ducks getting a goal and a half got shut out. Brutal.
That is brutal. That's a bad beat, man. You had to get greedy. What would if you had left Ducks out? If you had left them out, what would you have won if you went 11
for 11? All right.
What would you have won if you didn't put the stinking Ducks in there?
Before Tony goes all Sanford and Sons on you again.
Elizabeth, I'm coming to see you now, honey. I'm coming to see you now. Stop, Dean. People are ripping you. Indiana State might have lost, but the game would have been more competitive. The Ducks quacked under pressure.
Guess what? I didn't watch that game last night, and I'm not going to watch Indiana State. I don't give a rat's ass about these play-in games and these first-round games because they mean nothing.
This is the NIT. Indiana State's in the NIT tonight. You watch that kid ball his ass off.
One time. How many times is a 16 CB to one? Once in 100 years? It means squat, Tony.
They're not a 16 seed. Indiana State would not have been a 16 seed, Dean. Are you new at this shit, man? What about basketball, man?
They've been damn close to one.
Got to get him out of here, right?
Boys.
Cut him off, man.
Look at that big ass. Look at
Dean.
Big, juicy
we love you.
All right, guys.
Bye.
Even Jim Calhoun just called in. Even Jim Calhoun just called in and he said,
get some facts and come back and see me.
Exactly, man. What you know about basketball? Now my rib hurts.
See what
I may have pulled a muscle just arguing with Dean.
Because
I'm not even moving.
This is the problem. When you are moving because you talk with your hands and then you argue and
that's how I get my cardio
You just become louder and your arm movements become
bigger.
It's
not my style to go off like that. You know, and Dean and I have had some of the greatest radio and forths.
They're on YouTube.
And that may be the first time in a long time that I had to actually dress down Dean. Because I know the people all over the world listening to this, in Phoenix, wherever you are, in Finland, in Europe, all over the world.
Joe Quilson, my balls itch now. What? How does that correlate? I don't get it.
Exactly. They're not 16. The 16 seeds are like the Wagners, you know, and they had a great game last night. There's two 16s and then there's two 10s. Two 10s played last night. The other two 10s are going to play tonight. So it's the 16 seeds obviously don't have a chance, but they'll make it interesting because if you look at the numbers on these 1-16 matchups so far, there's no like 40-point lines there. They're like 25. Which you would expect that to be the difference. But as we saw in the conference tournaments last week, there were a lot of big favorites choking away or not giving a shit in the championship games. All of these big favorites, if you just bet underdogs last weekend watching these conference tournaments, you could have retired on taking all the dogs. They all covered. How many favorites actually covered the number last weekend? Ridiculous, man.
D. Conrad saying, what's wrong with the stream? It stopped.
It stopped on Rumble?
I don't think so.
Maybe they thought I was rumbling too much.
I'm actually watching it, so it did not stop.
It didn't. Don't stop. Can't stop.
Won't stop. Dean, D. Conrad, just refresh your page.
I got to go refresh in the bathroom before we bring in Tim Brando.
Okay.
I may have peed a little in myself after doing that. I've been drinking a lot of water today to keep hydrated.
Man, you are Sanford and Son. I mean, you are the dad going,
first,
oh,
between,
good Lord.
Between seeing the ground finally scraped clean and then Dean
you got excited,
setting me off.
And then more excited.
And it's not because I'm an old guy. You know what I mean? And it happens to a lot of people, Robin. You know, sometimes you just pee a little bit. Right?
Yeah.
Oh, it happens to everybody, right?
That happens to pretty much everybody, especially women who've had children.
Exactly.
You know, you laugh, you cough, you get tickled.
Exactly. It happens to all of us, folks. I recommend not talking to Dean from Clearwater, Florida for the next couple of weeks so that you don't have to listen to his absolute abject failure. He's more of a failure knowing about college basketball than Virginia is at playing basketball. I think they're going to go back. Tony Bennett's going to put a peach basket up in Charlottesville, and then they're going to have a downtown rally and see how many people in the streets can make baskets in a peach basket on the streets in downtown Charlottesville. It's embarrassed. It's embarrassing. Embarrassing.
Well, before you get embarrassed anymore.
I'm not embarrassed. It's embarrassing. I'm embarrassed for them. How about that? I'm really, 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 really. I'll tell you what I want. I want to bring in the great man who understands the college game. Whether it's football or whether it's basketball, he does them all, and he's one of the best ever in the business. The great Tim Brando joins us from the Chateau in Louisiana. Next, as we'll continue to talk basketball. Plus, we'll have a yard sale update. We'll have what the kids are doing. Look what the kids are doing today. And we'll have the happiest country on earth.
And
plus a Florida update, too.
Yeah, well, if we can get it everything, and if we can get it that and more, I'll even tell you why I'm really upset that I cut my hair now.
Yeah, we have a don't cut your hair, chicks, update. That's not my survey.
No.
This is science, and we will present you the scientific facts. Facts only on the show. Coming back with Tim Brando. Stick around.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
It's basically tennis for babies, but for adults.
It should be called Wiffle Tennis.
Pickle!
Yeah.
Yeah, we pop up on them like a pina.
You guys are intense.
We got nothing to worry about. With E-Trade from Morgan Stanley, we're ready for whatever gets served up.
Dude, you gotta work on your trash talk.
I'd rather work on saving for retirement.
Or college, since you like to get schooled. That's a good burn, right?
Got him.
Game.
Thanks for coming to our clinic. First one's free.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Athletic Grind Protector Inventor.
Mr. Athletic Grind Protector Inventor.
People love to play sports, but they don't love it when they get hit in the twig and berries.
Ah!
For years, cringing fans watched as man after man went down. But then you came along and said, here, stick this in your pants.
Nice to meet you.
The errant headbutt, the inside fastball, the wayward high five, all no match for your crash helmet.
I'll bring it on.
Sure, some athletes shun them, but don't worry, they'll come around.
Show us the way.
So crack open an ice-cold Bud Light protector of the package and know that we're just nuts about you.
We're just nuts.
Bud Light beer at us.
Make no sense. Marinated in Louisiana spices, hand battered and flipped, and then we have the audacity to call all five flavors fast food? Someone should really say something or order something.
Have that chicken from Popeye.
Did you ever read about a frog who dreamed of being a king and then became one? Well, except for the names and a few other changes, if you talk about me, the story's the same one. But I got an emptiness deep inside that I've tried, but it won't let me go. And I'm not a man who likes to swear, but I never cared for the sound of being alone. I am myself.
Okay, Bobby.
To no one there. And no one heard at all, not even the chair. I cried. I am, said I. And I am lost, and I can't even say why.
Punch Buddy Red.
I am a sin.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've been waiting, and now it's here. TBSN, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Make some noise!
The Tony Bruno Sports Network. Download the app, tell your friends, the game is on. TBSN.
Dude.
Oceans apart, day after day.
We're chilling now after an exciting first hour of the broadcast.
Yes, I figured that you needed to lower your blood pressure a little bit. You know, just.
And where's my pulse ox? Let me get that on. I should have put it on during the Dean, that phone call.
And watched it go up and explode.
If I went to triple digits.
Yeah, Wayne Atkinson, a down-tempo number. Yes, but we needed it. We needed it.
What do you think let's see what my pulse ox is right now as we get ready
for
10
grand. Well,
your
pulse ox should be fine because you got a lot of oxygen in while you were yelling.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I've chilled now. I went to the bathroom. I had some water. Listened to Neil Diamond. Oh, there it is, 97
so
over
that's good.
98.
And your blood pressure, that's
over
what
68. Is that good? Is 98 over 68 good, or am I
68
dead?
Is your pulse, your
right,
pulse
98
rate.
Right, 98 is my oxygen.
Yes, so that's
my
good.
My pulse gonna... rate now is, what's going up now? Because you're making me anxious.
I'm making you anxious.
No, that's got it down to 73. What's it supposed to be, Robin? It's a down-tempo number is exactly yeah. Right.
That was on purpose.
98, 75, Robin.
That's good. You're good.
Thank you. I just want to make sure. This is a show about health.
You are alive. I'm going to. I tried calling Tim. He wasn't answering the phone, so I'm going to call him back in just a second.
Okay. Is he at the chateau?
I'm assuming he's at the chateau.
By the way, one of the great stories in this tournament is, you know, you're going to see it tonight. I mean, Grambling State, you know, Grambling's a football school, right? It always has been. Legendary coaches, Eddie Robinson. You know, they had. Look at the quarterbacks that they've taken out of there. And that last year, they're in that SWAC conference. SWAC. Southwestern Athletic Conference. And last year, they lost as the top seed in the tournament, and it kept the Tigers as the only SWAC member whose players never experienced the ceremonial title game of cutting down the nets. So that was in 2023. This year, the seniors now who remember that pain, they'll be playing in their first tournament in Dayton, Ohio tonight in the first four. And so, big game, and that's why I picked Grambling State tonight. You know, I don't know much about Montana State, and obviously I don't know much about Grambling State, but I do know their history, and I know this school is committed, and Dante Johnson, the head coach down there, you know, when you're talking about being a coach at one of the historically black universities and go out there and accomplish it in football and now accomplish it in college basketball, that's a hell of a job. So I'll be rooting for them tonight. I don't know anything about Montana. Even Robin, who lived in Montana, doesn't even know where Montana State is. Now, where's Montana State? Robin, do you know where Montana State is?
I did not live in Montana, but...
I know, you had family up there.
Yes, my ex-husband is from there, and Bozeman is where Montana State is.
Now, where is Montana, the University of Montana?
The University of Montana is in Missoula.
Missoula, Montana, and then Bozeman.
Yes.
That's where Montana State is tonight, and they'll be playing in this 10-10 game. 10 seeds against each other. No, these are 16 seeds, I'm sorry. Colorado and Boise State are the 10 seeds. And they'll be playing later on tonight in the last two of the first four in. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, no, Montana's beautiful. You know, I've never been to Montana, Robin.
It's beautiful.
I know it's beautiful. Isn't that big sky country out there? I need to get out to that area. It's an outrage. Anyway, let's get it back. So we're waiting for Tim Brando. I mentioned while we're doing this, we should do a Jim Harbaugh yard sale update. Because remember yesterday, Robin, there was a lot of conflicting news about Jim Harbaugh. Oh, no, he's got him now. Okay, Timmy's calling in right now. He's probably down on the chateau just putting the clubs away, taking off the spikes. Watching the replay of Scottie Scheffler last weekend, getting ready for the next tour stop this week. A man who gets out now that college season is over for him as far as doing broadcasts. So what's he do when he's not calling into the show after Miss Robin pesters him to get him off the golf course to come in from the chateau? He's calling into the show because even he understands what happened to Virginia last night. Ladies and gentlemen, the great Tim Brando, a man who will now decry the tournament selection committee, much like he decries the college football playoff system.
Hey, somebody's got to do this, right, John? Somebody's got to do it.
Well, I mean, Wally Zerbiak said it last night, and he's on the network that has the tournament games. Was he right? Was Virginia? Is that the worst tournament performance? No, listen, we're talking about a big time school here. It's not small town program,
right? I mean, it probably reminded a lot of their fans of their performance in a 16-1 game a few years ago.
Yep.
But, of course, that was fuel to go out and win a national championship the next year. So, you know, who knows? But, I to some extent, through the course of this week, have been defending the committee because what happened with all of the teams that were on the bubble is they got debunked. They got blown up by bid stealing, and a lot of the fans, and especially the media. Oh my God!
I hate the media, Tim. I hate the media. Seriously.
How many people that are in the business of supposedly following sports and are supposed to be explaining why this or that happened have no clue about the 36 and 32 factor that comes into play with automatic bids and at-large entries? When you have that many teams that were nestled around the bubble, both in it and just out of it, and the bracketologists, whether it's DeCourcy, who's a great writer, Lenardi, who I think is, to his credit as an old sports information man, has turned himself into, you know, the Mel Kiper of college basketball.
Yep.
You can explain it away all you want, but people just don't understand it. And if you were into or out of first four out, first four, last four in, all that, you were in peril if you were going to see teams like NC State win five games in 5 days or Oregon do what they did in the final year of the Pac-12. the bid stealing was incredible. And poor Indiana State, a team that absolutely deserved to go, every bit as much as St. John's or Providence or
Seton Hall,
yeah. All three of those teams clearly deserved to be in. I went into the Big East tournament last week saying, well, at least six are going to go. I mean, I didn't anticipate that we'd have that many. Sometimes we have one or two stolen bids, but never usually more than that. My God, we had five. Now
is this like a stolen election now? Or I don't want people to call you an NCAA tournament denier, a bid-stealing denier.
Well, the truth is, unlike the college football committee, which clearly is totally corrupt in every way, and when you're picking only four teams, you pretty much have to be corrupt to get it the way you want it, mm-hmm. you know, each year. The committee for the NCAA tournament has just all these metrics that they have to use, and they follow them by the letter. You know, they tried to coerce the media into understanding by inviting all of us up there. I turned them down every time they did it because I thought it was just wasted time. I was doing my radio show back in those days. I didn't have time to go to Dallas and be in a meeting room with, you know, for 3 days with a bunch of guys that, you know, are basically being fed so they'll keep their mouth shut and not be critical. I mean, that's what they were doing. So I said, the hell with that. But the truth is, those guys, they are pencil pushing guys that are athletic directors and commissioners, all of them. They don't have any basketball people on that committee. Okay, they got administrators on that committee. But even if you had basketball people on the committee, it wouldn't matter because the metrics that they have to follow, the guidelines are so stringent that, you know, you can't deviate. So it was understandable that people would really be upset, particularly the Big East and Patino. And we know that league was the second best league in the country this year. And for them to only get three bids, oh, my God. I mean, that was just that was like an atomic bomb hitting that conference. And so you look at those that did get in. Okay, all right, who escaped all of that? Virginia did.
Yep.
And their metrics weren't that good. In fact, there are several teams, including Indiana State, including St. John's, that had better metrics than UVA did when it comes to the net, which replaced the RPI, when it comes to strength of schedule, all those things. You know, Virginia was you know, middle of the road to back tier when it came to that. And yet they got in. So the bottom line is it's easy to point the finger now to all the naysayers that say, oh, yeah, Tony Bennett, part of the establishment, good guy. Now his program, because he's won a national title, if not a blue blood, it's close to a blue blood. They get in. And the basketball-only schools in the Big East that hire a coach that was in exile like Patino, they look down their noses at him because of, you know, past inadequacies, perhaps, on his career. And so it gives them a voice. I don't think that's good for the game. I don't. But it's a shame that it happened, and it speaks to, I think, the level of embarrassment that the committee must feel today, and to a certain extent, I think, the ACC should feel today. Because, you know, that's a team that's not that far removed from a national championship. And, my God, 14 points and a half? I mean, Colorado State's good, and I don't mean to be slamming Colorado State because that league did get six teams in. And by the way, they deserve six teams, and they got screwed on their seedings. All those teams don't deserve to be at or around double-digit seedings, but they are. Okay, so the committee clearly wants the Mountain West to be Ixnayed, you know, in 2 days. Okay,
right.
And that at least Colorado State is still playing, and we'll be playing in Charlotte. So, yeah, it was a bad deal, no doubt about it. But in the final analysis, you know, I'm never going to throw the NCAA Tournament Selection Committee under the bus the way I would the corrupt college football playoff committee, because that is just, I mean, they some of those people should be serving time, for Christ's sakes. I mean, it's just, my God, how can you get away with doing what they did to Florida State the way they did? So it's different, but at the same time, the criticism is certainly warranted today, no doubt about it.
Now, Tim Brando, of course, I was living vicariously through you on your Twitter feed with all the great people that you ran into. And when you go to New York and you're at Madison Square Garden and there's so many muckety mucks and friends and people that you know and coaches, I mean, it is still the world's second most famous arena. So that had to be fun being at the Big East and doing the Big East tournament up there in New York City.
Yeah.
How many different rounds? Now, did you go to what's the old hangout where Steinbrenner and those guys used to go, the bar?
Well, back in the day, Runyon's, you mean? No, that place is no longer around. Boy, if those walls could talk, right? Oh, my God. And the old joint where Brent Musburger took a shot at the Greek, and the Greek took a shot at Brent, all that was in You Are Looking Live, the book that my friend Rich Podolsky wrote, all those. There are a lot of haunts there, no doubt about it. I did get the Carmine. You would have been proud of me, our Fox family, at our Tuesday night gathering at Carmine's. And by the time I had gotten through with my Caesar salad and a little bit of pasta, not much, I had no room for chicken parmesan. I had no room.
Oh, come on, man. What kind of an Italian are you? Your wife's Italian? Well, you don't know how to pace yourself when you're at a great Italian restaurant, the legendary Carmine's in New York?
Apparently not. I've dropped 55 pounds, and I'm a lightweight now. You know, I just can't do it anymore. You know, and hell, I only had a little Prosecco. I'm not even drinking red wine anymore. I had a little Prosecco, and I was full. I had to wake up. My Wednesday, Tony, was a long day. Now, it was a wonderful day, maybe one of the greatest individual days from a career standpoint I've ever experienced. I got up at about 6:30 in the morning. I had an 8 a.m. pickup. Our PR lady from Fox, Ann Pennington, took me over to Fox and Friends, where I did a hit for the tournament there. And then I went over to MSG, where Tina Servasio, the longtime sports anchor there, did a piece on the tournament with Menifee on the wake up Fox 5 in the morning show. And then I went back to the hotel, where I took a little cat nap of about 90 minutes. This shows you that I'm now truly a Beano Cook, Bill Raftery senior in waiting. At age 60.
But still an active senior. You're a senior, but you're an active senior.
Active senior. Then I took a shower and I got ready, went over back to MSG, where they awarded me with the Jim O'Connell Award, the Big East Jim O'Connell Award for sports media, for media, which was a real honor.
Absolutely. Congrats on that. Congrats, brother.
Thank you. I got pretty emotional with that one, because it represented not only what I was doing at Fox now, but, you know, how I got started covering the Big East and college basketball in general. In 1985, woke up some echoes of my days with Dickie V and with Raph doing my first Big East game with Bill, with Seton Hall and St. John's and later Villanova, and got to tell a few stories about that. But for Val Ackerman, who, of course, succeeded Mike Oresco, was only there for a short time as they pulled those football schools out and formed the American. But the memories of Dave Gavitt and his nicknaming me Dixie, I don't think that anyone will ever be a broadcaster for the Big East tournament will ever be from as far south as me. Okay, so I cracked the code on being a Northeast broadcaster of Big East basketball. And between you and me, Tony, I do think having a vowel on the end of my name definitely helped.
Oh,
no,
absolutely.
Question about it.
Absolutely. Add, come on, man. Come on.
Why wouldn't it? Of course,
exactly.
It had to. You know, I mean, for Christ's sake, I know people. So that in and of itself was a very flattering day. Hell, and you'll be happy, my acceptance speech was only about 8 to 10 minutes, but I had to hang for a while because, as you well know, Tony, I've got to take care of my public afterwards. So I did stay for a while, hang out and talk to some people, and then I had 3 games to call. You know, I had to go and do 3 games, which is, it's not like 4 games in the NCAAs, but 3 is a lot for somebody.
Yeah, you're doing 3 nationally televised games at the world's second most famous arena, MSG.
Well, by the way, which is the first? Is it the Spectrum?
No, it's the Colosseum in Rome. Come on.
The Colosseum
in Rome is the world's most famous arena.
What was I thinking? Domino's Movie.
At Cum Spirit 220. Or Hawaii 50, or whatever OOO, or Uzo, or any of the other good things that end in a vowel.
I can't believe I asked that question. Shame on me. That's an extra 2 days in purgatory when I'm 6 feet up, waiting to see Vino, you know?
Now, anyway, Tim,
it was a great day. It was great.
It was great watching that stuff, man. I love watching college basketball. And the great thing about college basketball season, you know, they don't force it on you. I mean, we know when you got the football season ends, and college basketball has started by that point. But then people realize it, the college coaches, the students, everybody knows that once you hit February, that's when people start laser focusing in on college hoops.
Well, I do, and I think a significant number of people in media that are maybe, you know, past 55 years of age feel that way.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, Tony, geez, I mean, you watch mainstream cable television now, and they're still regurgitating the same drivel about, you know, how much more money are they going to give Fields and what's going to go on with Dak and Bronny and LeBron. I mean, gee, my God. Can we move on, shall we, for Christ's sake?
That's what we do. We keep it fresh here every day, Tim. Now, I had Phil Martelli on yesterday, and you know Phil, great guy.
Love him.
He's still up there in Ypsilanti because, you know, the coaching staff was fired, and then he still has a contract through April. So I said, Phil, what are you doing? Because he was going to come on with me last week, but then, you know, everything hit the fan, and they fired their head coach, Juwan Howard, and so he's still under contract, so he doesn't know what he's going to do next, but he's got his son who coaches up at Bryant in Rhode Island. He's got another son coaching. Yep. And obviously the bad blood between him and St. Joe's was sort of surprising because he was really hurt when they let him go. But we got to talk about the portal, and even he, a guy who's there taking care of kids at Michigan, who some of whom have already entered the portal, in condemning the decision to open the transfer portal on the day after they announced the tournament. I mean, who did that, Tim, and why would they do something that dumb when you have the biggest event in college basketball of the year coming up in a few days?
Because the NCAA undermines all things that are really good for the college game, okay? I mean, they do, whether it's football or basketball. I think they hone in more on screwing football than basketball. But, I mean, think about that. How negligent could that possibly be? But it goes on. I mean, your own worst enemy is, look in the mirror, you found it, it's you. It goes on all the time. It just goes on all the time. Fans have no idea, and some of the media have no idea how coaches have a right, many of them, to be pissed. I know it sounds bad because they're making millions and they're the faces that people recognize that are associated with the schools, but it's pathetic. I mean, what they're doing. It absolutely is. Tell him when you talk to him again. I hope to see him at the Final Four. I'm emceeing the.
Yeah, he's going to Phoenix. He is going to Phoenix.
All right, so I'll see him there.
Absolutely. Now, the other story today is, because, you know, you can't turn around. I mean, Stanford, obviously, out of the Pac-12, gone. So Peja Stojakovic's son, freshman, he entered the portal yesterday. Top 25 recruit. You know, he only played 1 year in Palo Alto. He goes, and then the other freshman, a top 50 kid, Kanan Carlisle, he's also in the portal. And so what happens to programs now? I know they're not in the Pac-12 anymore, but Stanford's still going to play basketball next year.
Right. Yeah, they're going to be in the ACC.
Yep.
Try that on for size, right?
Will they be able to beat Virginia, though, without those players? That's the big question.
They might have a shot with Virginia based on It is crazy what's going on, and it's going to be a very active off season, get ready for some wild and crazy headlines, you know, moving forward. You know, I have to apologize because I don't have my normal amount of time. I love the soiree with you for, you know, on and on again, but I got to leave in about 5 minutes.
Okay, so no problem.
Can I give you my Final Four? Because
absolutely,
you know. And people are going to think right away, oh, Brando's a homer. They gave him an award, and now he's a lapdog. But I'm not. Okay, the one good thing the tournament selection committee, or as I like to say because I'm doing the Big East now, the tournament selection committee.
The tournament.
As opposed to the, you know, Hootie Johnson at Augusta, the tournament, or in the South it would be tournament, and of course in the Big East. Hell, I would have not kept my job doing Big East basketball had I not understood that it really was tournament, not tournament.
Tournament.
All right, so.
I'm writing them down now, Tim.
Get ready, all right.
Now, you're not going all chalk, all number one seeds, are you?
No.
Okay.
The one thing that I did say that the committee did a nice job of for the Big East was they didn't drop Marquette from the two line, all right? And they didn't drop Creighton terribly either, and they got bounced in the quarterfinals of the Big East tournament. So those two teams at twos and threes, and if you look at their draws, okay, tell me the team that has the best chance of beating Purdue and keeping them from going to the Final Four. And by the way, I'd love to see Purdue make it to the Final Four. Matt Painter's probably the best guy and the best coach not to have a team ever get to the Final Four. I think a lot of people are rooting for him.
Yep.
But tell me the team on their side of the bracket that's got the best chance of beating him.
Matchup. Creighton?
Yes, without a doubt.
Yep.
Why? Ryan Kalkbrenner. If you want to match up with Edie, you got the defensive player of the year. You got a 7-footer that can play for 37 minutes and not foul. Creighton doesn't foul. I mean, they play good defense and they don't foul. And they've got what? Multiple guys that can score. And I think that's a matchup problem. I think Creighton knocks Purdue out in the regional finals. So Creighton goes.
Wow.
Now tell me the team that's got the best chance of knocking Houston out on their side of the bracket in the South. Just matchup-wise, when you look at the teams out there, I know some are going to say Kentucky because, you know, they got massive personnel, they're blue blood, they got size, but do they defend? Does Kentucky defend? No, Kentucky does not defend. Who has the best chance?
Now, that's in the West you're talking about, or in the South?
The South.
That's right. Houston's one, and let's see, they got Longwood. I think Longwood will be able to squeak by in that opening round match. So I'm going to go out on a limb and say
they'll get past Longwood. They'll get past everybody. I do have a sleeper in that side. I think James Madison, the Dukes, will take care of Duke in the second round. And I think James Madison will take care of Wisconsin. So James Madison, okay, that's a 12 seed to the final, to the Sweet 16. Marquette is your team. They're getting Kolick back. And that team is driven.
Yeah.
Getting Kolick back and the way they defend, and Oso Iguodaro, those guys, they have what it takes to beat Houston. Marquette's going to the Final Four.
Wow.
Wake up the echoes of Al McGuire. Seashells and balloons. Marquette's going. So you add those two to the mix with UConn, that's three Big East teams in the Final Four, first time since 85. We all remember what happened there. The team that's going to knock out North Carolina is Arizona. Arizona gets to go home and play in the Final Four. So the three Big East teams plus Arizona. And I've got UConn matching up with Creighton in the finals and the Huskies winning 90-86. So there you have it.
Wow.
It's all there.
That is.
It's all there.
That's knowledge. Because, you know, everybody, oh, I like the one seeds. And, oh, baby. But how about the school down here, though, that the Florida Atlantic kids, the John L. Davis kid, a senior, they made the run last year. They got Northwestern Friday. Can they make a deep run again this year?
Well, they could, but Northwestern shoots it well now. You know, if Boo Booey goes off, I don't know that they've got a guy to match up. Now, they've got the big kid. I think they've got a bad seed. I mean, that was just a horrible seed for them to be in an 8-9 game. You know, Northwestern probably deserved to be in an 8-9 game. I thought FAU got screwed. I thought the American got screwed. I thought USF should have been in. You know, our friend Mike Oresco's, you know, it's part of his problem. That's why he's retiring. I think, you know, it's happened time and time again. That league's better than the tournament selection committee has treated them. Let me give you two other quick teams to the Sweet 16. I
got
to run.
Okay, you got Creighton and Marquette, and then you also had who was the third team?
What? That's in the Final Four?
You gave me Creighton and Marquette. Arizona.
And Marquette. Yep.
And Houston.
Three Big East schools plus Arizona are in the Final Four. But here are my two teams cracking the Sweet 16 that are 12s.
Okay.
Grand Canyon, the Fighting Bryce Drews.
Yes.
And James Madison, the Dukes. The Dukes take down Wisconsin and Duke, the original Duke.
Wow.
So
Grand Canyon and who was the second team there? You said taking down Duke,
McNeese State, baby.
Oh, McNeese State. Do we call it McNeese or McNeese? It's Mac.
I got three teams. Okay, states that weren't states. McNeese State. Valvano said, stay away from it. You got to stay away from them. McNeese State will take down Kansas in the second round. So McNeese State, James Madison, Grand Canyon, Bracket Busters, there you have it.
Ladies and gentlemen, you normally would have to pay $30, $40, $50, $100 to get this kind of information elsewhere on a special recorded line, but Tim Brando releasing them absolutely for you and for Jay Billis and anybody else and Wally Zerbiak and all the other great basketball minds. Tim, it's always great to talk to you. Get back on the golf course down at the Chateau, man. Tee them up.
By the way, there's only one nation besides Sooner Nation. I get tired of that. That's Gator Nation. It's this nation. No, there's two nations. There's Sooner Nation. All right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's Sooner Nation. That was right. The only nation until Bruno Nation.
Exactly.
God bless and keep you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. The man himself, the great Tim Brando. Thanks, Tim. God. How much do I love Tim Brando, Robin? And more importantly, how much do you love Tim Brando?
I love Tim Brando.
And the guy never ages.
No.
He looks the same as he did 20, 30 years ago when I was working with him.
He does. He does.
It's a smart man right there. And he's a professional broadcaster, too. That's the other thing. He's not just a great guy. Not just a great, knowledgeable college guy. He's a great broadcaster. A Hall of Fame broadcaster.
Yes.
He is.
Dean agrees with you.
One Nation Raider Nation.
Freeform Aggie, yeah. no, I agree. The Bruno Nation. Bruno Nation is the number one nation. All the other ones are good, too, but Bruno Nation.
Well, then there's Eternal Damnation. That's another nation that a lot of people will be joining after Easter.
We want to avoid that one.
Eternal Damnation.
I'm avoiding that one like the plague.
I don't think I'll escape that one, Robin. I think I'm pretty much locked in as a top five seed in the Eternal Damnation bracket.
Your mom might agree with you. The fact that she kept trying to get you to go to church and...
Now, should I go to church for Easter, Robin? I have not. I didn't go to church for Christmas, right?
Mm-hmm. When's the last time you truly went to church?
I don't remember.
I think it was for your mom's funeral.
Yeah, and I hate going to churches for funerals. Yeah. I mean, that's where you got to go, but... Weddings and funerals. I don't like either one, actually.
That's why we're not getting married in a church.
Little jungle. Tarzan, right?
Correct.
And who was the group that did this, Robin?
This is Baltimora.
Baltimora.
Tarzan Boy.
Tarzan Boy. Who you calling boy? Crank it up, Robin. We're coming back. Your calls, your texts. We'll have the Harbaugh yard sale update.
And actually, we just got confirmation that the fabulous Brendan Armstrong from Jack's New Year's.
Oh, is he going to call in?
He's going to be on in the 5 o'clock hour.
Oh, awesome. That's a great story. And I'm wearing the shirt that he got me back in 2019 that has now led to an unbelievable success story. If you don't cry over this, I was crying when I saw this story. And we're going to have a guy who helped make this happen in the Philadelphia market when it was involving St. Louis and the Blues back in the 2019 Stanley Cup run. So we got that coming up and a whole bunch more. Stick around having fun on a What Up Wednesday on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
36,000 feet in the air.
Excuse me. Is there a doctor on the plane?
I'm a doctor.
The name's Umstick. Dr. Umstick. Get my bag. Stat.
Sure.
Sweet, creamy relief.
Oh, am I going to be okay?
I have no idea. I'm not a body doctor.
What? Mm. Where did you all get those?
Can somebody help me?
So good.
I'm sorry about him.
Another day, another drumstick.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Bowling Shoe Giver Outer.
Mr. Bowling Shoe Giver Outer.
Your tireless efforts keep our feet comfy and sanitized with mountain freshness.
Mountain freshness.
Instinctively, you match left shoe with right. Carefully placing each pair in its own tiny shoe house.
Check the number on the back.
One wrong move, and we're on the fast train to Blisterville.
Oh, yeah.
Is he a 9.5 or a 10?
Oh, yeah.
You know. Why? because you're Mr. Bowling Shoe Giver Outer.
We couldn't know without you.
So crack open an ice cold Bud Light, mister, and know it's no accident those shoes are red, white, and blue.
No, we couldn't know without you.
Bud Light beer and
ice mountain, the stakes get higher.
I can't get that thing up there. If it were a football, I'd be able to reach the top.
What about a football-shaped head? We throw the child.
Gutsy call, sir.
Smart thinking.
What? No, that's dumb thinking. He's not throwing Arnold.
Throw him.
Throw him. Throw him. Throw him.
Hey, do you want an immunity idol?
Throw him.
A what? You can't throw a child at a wall.
Lattimore, shut your face.
Shut me.
Unless you prefer to freeze to death.
I'm not gonna throw a kid.
Not built for the moment, I see. Fine. I'll throw him.
And Creed's here.
Watch and learn.
Dang, he's cool.
It's the fifth quarter, and we need a hole-in-one before the seventh inning stretch. Be brave. Pep, hike!
Can you take me higher? To the place where lying man see.
I just threw him higher.
Come on.
To a place where we won't freeze.
He just threw me home. I'm good.
So close.
How are we gonna get up there?
Now, if there were only someone made of pigskin.
Bingo.
Oh, dear.
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Prince Onage, right?
Onage, I think.
Prince,
right?
Onage?
I think it's...
KC says, am I the only guy on your Twitter feeds? This platform feels abandoned. No, we got 480 people listening just on the Twitter feed, watching right now on the Twitter feed. Plus, we got Rumble going. What else do we have, Robin?
Facebook. YouTube.
Yep. Got it all going on, man.
Yeah, it's really weird. So... we're seeing you, Prince Onage, and then you can see all of the from the comments from the different platforms. We're there.
We're in the air, everywhere.
I do agree, though, that the Twitter responses are kind of funny how they show up. So, but definitely there. When you're watching it, you can see them all on the sideline there.
Exactly. By the way, this breaking news from the Babylon Bee, a court judge has just flipped a coin to see if Texas is allowed to enforce its laws today. I mean, they keep going back every hour. It changes. Oh, no, don't arrest us. Okay, now you can go out there. It's insane what's going on. Now, meanwhile.
In honor of this being the first day of.
The first actual full day of spring.
And.
The tournament. The NCAA tournament.
And start
Major League Baseball,
yes.
Where the Dodgers beat the Padres in Seoul.
And
the NIT.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on. But yeah. Jim, the official archivist of the Tony Bruno Show,
yes.
Has a clip from back in the day. Jim, you're on the line.
How far? Hey, Jim, how are you? How far back are we going back in the time?
This would be March of 2007.
March of 2007. How many years ago was that?
This is before Robin. BMR.
BMR.
This is where you're doing your
That's Big Mama Radio's BMR, yeah. So I was doing shows with who?
You were doing your sporting news show, and that day you did your show live from Clearwater, Florida, before the Phillies game. And they asked you to throw out the first ball of the Philly spring training game.
That's right. And I was there with
you did that, and then 2 minutes after you finished up, you're on the air with Gary.
Exactly. That's the kind of dedication to the craft that you don't see anymore with these young whippersnappers doing this broadcasting thingy-majiggy. Because Mark Willard and I were there, I remember. And we were there. And then the original world-famous Hooters girls, because the original Hooters opened in Clearwater, Florida. So they were there. They were rubbing my head with sunscreen to protect me from the sun of in Clearwater, Florida, as you know, this time of the year. Now, Jim, did you ever come down here to go to any games?
I didn't get I couldn't get down there this year.
It happens. Now, you know, the opening day is next Thursday.
Next Thursday.
Yep. But the Dodgers opened today, got a win over the Padres. Otani got a couple of hits, his first RBI. But we got to go back to show you the kind of – and again, I don't prompt Jim to pull this stuff out. He has it in the archives. This is now 2007. The Phillies, remember, were building up to a World Series championship team.
The Phillies had all these great young players, Ryan Howard, Jimmy Rollins, Chase Utley, Cole Hamels. As a matter of fact, Cole Hamels, before the game, we were giving you some tips before you were throwing out the first
Exactly. And then look what happened. I go down there, I throw out the first pitch at the Phillies in 2007, and bam! The next year, they win the World Freaking Series. And the great, you mentioned the great Chase Utley.
Chase Utley was that year when the MVP.
He was the MVP, but remember, Chase Utley's world-famous speech.
World champion!
Exactly right, man. Never forget that, Jim. Never forget it. Let's go back to the tape out there before it was Bay Care Ballpark.
As soon as you threw the pitch, you're on the air 1 minute later on with Gary.
Let's hear this kind of versatility not known to other young people on the face of the air.
That's an outrage. Here is the fabulous Bruno. Tony, were you low and outside or down the middle?
No, Gary, I threw it high and outside, and the catcher had to jump. Rob Barajas had to jump out of the crouch and go up and get it, Gary, but it didn't go to the backstop. Cole Hamels gave me some last-minute instructions, and as you know, Gary, the pressure, when you're not throwing on the mound, they wouldn't let me go up because Brett Lyre-Myers didn't want me to mess up his mound.
Oh.
So I had to throw from the front of the mound, the flat surface, and I wasn't quite ready. If I had been up on the rubber, Gary, towing the rubber, as the big right-hander Krug would instruct me, I threw the three-seamer, and it just sailed a little high, but it had a lot of velocity on it, at least. I didn't bounce it up there, Gary.
Now, give us all the details. You are where, who's playing, and who invited you to throw out the pitch?
It's a beautiful first day. Bright house, Networks Field, Gary, Clearwater, Florida, with the Phillies and the Toronto Blue Jays just underway. We have played the top frame, and the Blue Jays have been put down in order, Gary. Of course, former Oakland A great. The greatness it is, Frank Thomas here. He's not here for the money. He's here to win a championship, Gary. And the Phillies and the Blue Jays are underway. But I was asked by the great Philly organization, because I am a Philadelphia native son, and I got to do my show from down on the field today. So it was a lot of fun seeing Ryan Howard and Shane Victorino, one of the greatest Hawaiian players ever, Gary.
Wow. How was your introduction?
It was good. It was a typical Philly crowd. You know, they cheered me when they introduced me, and then as soon as I threw it high, I got booed. So, I mean, that's what you get. You know, you got to be able to handle it. You got to have thick skin, Gary. When you're playing at a major league ballpark in a minor league city, Clearwater, Florida, Gary.
Yep. There you go, Tony.
How about that, huh? Now, can I claim some credit for being a lucky charm for the Phillies?
Abso-freaking-lutely.
I mean, they could have asked anybody to throw out a pitch. Down there. I threw out a pitch for the Angels on opening day in Anaheim back in 2005. 2 years later, I'm in Clearwater throwing out a first pitch.
Now, well, here's the question. How did the Angels do that year?
No, they sucked.
Yes,
that
amazing.
That was before they had...
That's the year where Jimmy Rollins, I think, was playing the Yankees in an exhibition game, and one of the New York writers asked him, who's going to win the National League East? He says, well, the Phillies are the team to beat. And all the New York people got upset, but then the Phillies won on the last day of the season.
Exactly right. You know your baseball, Jim. Are you ready for next week? Are you ready for it to count?
Oh, yeah, I'm ready. They're ready here, yeah. The weather was so good last week. Now the weather's really bad right now. It's like high up 41 today.
It's an outrage. I got to bring some better good weather up there. I mean, it's been chilly here, too. It was like in the high 50s last night. So it's cooled off, but there's no humidity, and it's a beautiful day for baseball, Jim. But I appreciate that clip.
And tonight we have some big NIT basketball tonight.
Yeah, you got St. Joe's in the first game starting out against Seton Hall up there at the Prudential Center in Newark, New Jersey. Then, of course, you got the Villanova Wildcats closing out the night, and they're playing at the Finneran Pavilion up there at Villanova, and they're at home and favored over VCU by 8.5.
See, I see ESPN 2. two picked the games they wanted to pick, and both were the Philadelphia schools.
Yeah, they got St. Joe's and Seton Hall on ESPN2, and you're right, the Villanova game on ESPN2 and ESPN+. I have ESPN- and CNN- on my platform right
well,
now.
Plus, so you have to pay for it. I think they charge $10 a month.
That's an outrage.
It is.
Do they know who I am? Do they not know? Does ESPN not know how instrumental I was to building that organization back
it's
in
an
the
outrage.
Day? It is an outrage.
It's unbelievable.
Thanks again, Jim. That was awesome.
Thank you, Jim.
And I left my heart in Virginia. That was pretty good.
Thank you. Every once in a while, I got to drop some old school. Because, you know, Tony Bennett's the coach of Virginia. So what do I do? My brain starts ticking. Let me do a Tony Bennett. I left my basketball program in San Francisco.
When is the music video coming out?
The music video, we're going to film it on the beach. Once the spring breakers get out of there, I'm going to go down to Fort Myers Beach, get a couple of dancing girls, like they have the dancing girls in Korea on the dugouts. Did you see what they're doing in Korea?
Yeah.
They got dancing girls,
smart.
And they got the whole thing going on, man.
Screw mascots.
Yeah, the Philly Fanatics want to get fired, man. We love the Philly Fanatics. If you had a choice of Philly Fanatic
or dancing girls,
I don't mean the girls like from cheerleaders and all of the local strip establishments. I'm talking about like college girls who can dance. You know what I mean?
I understand.
Keep them coming, Jim.
Okay, guys, have a good time.
There
okay,
he is, ladies bye. And gentlemen, the official archivist pulling out vintage tape.
That was great quality too.
Well, yeah, especially I wasn't winded. You see it? I actually went out there, threw the first pitch, and I got the Philadelphia welcome. And I didn't throw it over her head. I didn't throw it down. Because when you're on the flat surface in front of the mound, you can't get it, and you'll bring that leg all the way up like Don Drysdale and then come over the top with the two-seamer.
Mm-hmm.
If I had been on – and again, Brett Myers, he screwed me up. That son of a bitch.
Son of a bitch. Now, Tony.
Yes.
Here we are. We're talking about you. You had highs and lows today. You were angry. You were sad. You were happy.
I wasn't sad.
No.
I'm going to be sad when we do that story when we get the phone
call. Well, yes, but
not sad. It's going to be tears of joy.
You live in the United States, Tony.
Yes.
United States has fallen again.
And it can't get up.
And it's slipping behind, and we have scientific evidence now.
Yes, this is sad news for all of us, you know, because America is still the greatest country on earth. But today, the official yearly survey, this is not just some people throwing darts against the wall.
No.
Or the NCAA selection committee.
This is the Gallup World Happiness Report for
2024. This is the Gallup World Happiness Report. Ladies and gentlemen, which countries are the happiest on earth, and which ones are miserable sons of bitches. Let's go to your correspondent, ladies and gentlemen. Now, ABC News and Miss Robin Austin.
Let's go. Shall I just start off where the happiest? Because that's the news for the seventh year in a row.
Which country on
Finland.
Earth?
Finland.
Finland is number one again, seven consecutive
and
years,
clearly,
Robin.
Clearly.
That's why people are listening to this show in Finland,
yes,
because they're happy,
because
just like we are.
It makes them happy.
Exactly
right, because we do have Finland on our listeners' list.
Not the Schindler's List. Listeners' List?
No.
That doesn't sound good.
But it turns out that young people in the United States and Western Europe are becoming less satisfied with their lives, but Finland for...
It's all about that Nordic stock. Nordic countries are now what? The top 10?
Yeah, so
happiest countries on Earth?
Let me tell you. So
well, Netherlands isn't Nordic.
European...
Okay. You are trashing.
But even the Netherlands dropped a little bit. The top 25 countries, I'm not going to go through the entire thing.
But give us the top 10.
Number one, Finland, and then I'm just going to go down the list. Finland, Denmark, Iceland. Those are all up there. You would think that those cold places, that they would not be as happy. Because
Iceland, by the way, just had another one of those volcanoes. So that beach, what's it called? The Blue Lagoon has now been closed because of these continuing.
Yeah.
But people are still happy there.
So Finland, Denmark, Iceland, Sweden. Those are all those Nordic areas where they don't get a lot of sun during the winter. Yep. You would think that they would not be, but they are the top four. How many?
Oh, of course, it's the common number.
Four. Now, here's one. Clearly, scientific information was taken before October 7th, because number five on the list is Israel.
Mm-hmm. Well, people in Israel are still happy. The entire country is not under siege.
Well, I mean, right now it is.
No, now it's the Holy Land. I mean, it's Easter's coming up, Passover.
But overall, prior to that, Israel was definitely happy. The Netherlands, number six.
Number six.
Then we go back up north. Norway. We have Luxembourg, Switzerland, Australia. Mm-hmm. Go all the way down under. Australia, number 10. And then before you get to the United States,
Now, where are we now? Are we top 25, top 20?
Barely.
Wait a minute. The U.S. keeps dropping and dropping and dropping?
Dropping and dropping. The U.S. is now number 23.
23?
And this is based on the research is about, you know, are you happy with your environment, with your jobs, with your everything?
If you're happy and you know it, can you clap your hands?
Yes.
You know what that is, Robin. What are we, 23?
23.
And I don't think the U.S. has ever been lower than this.
Oh, this is the lowest. In the history of them doing this.
And you know what that is, don't you?
And we used to be the top 10.
It's all bullshit.
It is all bullshit.
We used to be in the top 10, and we are no longer. Now.
What do you mean, we? Who's we?
I'm living in the United States.
I'm joking, Robin.
Now, here is... somebody from Finland said that this is the reason why they think the Finns are happy.
They listen to the show, and that's helped the quotient as well.
The best parts of living and working in Finland include the beautiful nature and the generous 4 to 5 weeks of annual holiday.
How many weeks minimum do they get there of holiday?
Minimum 4 to 5. The Finnish concept of sisu. We know that word.
And we saw that's the greatest movie ever made. The greatest Nazi killing movie ever, Sisu.
You got to see it. It means resilience or grit, and our love of sauna are just a few ways that we keep our spirits high. Ultimately, however, I think trust is the biggest factor in Finnish happiness. There is a great deal of trust in our society between fellow citizens, and this also applies in the workplace between managers and employees. In my opinion, trust is the key for
It's about
happiness.
Trust.
And you know what? I would agree that because this country has
Nobody trusts anybody.
Nobody trusts
except
anybody.
Except this show. This is the only trustworthy show on earth. Ridiculous.
But we have lost trust in this, in our fellow citizens, in our government.
In our family, in our friends, and the people that listen, and the people who are out there bitching about jobs.
The government, the media has pitted us against each other, and that has created a lot of unhappiness.
By the way, the great Joe Quills, Finns are happy because they honor Jimmy Buffett. You know, two lines, Finns to the left, Finns to the right. We got to go to Margaritaville soon. It's now that it's open, Robin, over there in Fort Myers. The new big Buffett Margarita Resort.
It's open. Did you see the overhead shot?
Yeah,
the pool. It has like a lazy river and everything.
Yeah, I love lazy. I need to go there maybe this weekend. Yes.
Now, Joey B. says, always trust a man that wears a Play Gloria t-shirt on YouTube.
Well, I wear this because it was given to me by the Jacks New Year's Brigade.
Yes, by Brendan Armstrong.
Brendan Armstrong. It's a great story if people didn't know it. And we will relive it because the ending of this story is remarkable.
Yes.
Started out as a hockey thing, and we love hockey. And living in South Philly, you know, we'd go to the Flyers games. We're in the same neighborhood. We can walk. And then we found out about this bar. And we found out. Brendan's going to join us. Brendan Armstrong is going to join us in the 5 o'clock hour.
In the no filter hour.
And he's going to tell us the whole story, because it's hard to believe how all of this came to be. And now the happy ending that has occurred in the city of St. Louis. Put a call into Joe Buck today, because obviously Joe lives in St. Louis. And he was, and I went on, and the woman we're talking about, she's a young lady now, and her name is
Layla Anderson.
Layla Anderson. She was 8 years old and had basically a near fatal disease.
Correct.
It was a disease that very few people could survive.
Right. It was something called HLH or something like that, and it's a autoimmune disease where your body attacks itself for whatever reason, and it can attack anywhere. Hers attacked her brain, and
we'll get to tell you the whole story next hour. If you haven't seen it or heard it, you want to talk about believing in the power of love and
absolutely
people
amazing.
Reaching out. And again, I know people always ask for prayers, and you can believe that whoever you worship, if you just silently, somebody says, hey, my family, if you can, spare a prayer for my family, a prayer or thoughts or pleasant thoughts, and I think there is power of positive thinking, except when Dean calls in the show, then all goes out the window. But this is a story where I believe the power of the National Hockey League, the fans, the people in St. Louis, and the people all over the world who saw this story back in 2019. Remember, the St. Louis Blues won the Stanley Cup that year. And then we also got to see the Stanley Cup up close and personal.
Yes.
When the coach, who's no longer the coach there, he came out into the Philadelphia area and brought the Stanley Cup. Even Jack in the Back was there sipping from the Stanley Cup, even though the Flyers didn't win the Cup. It was the St. Louis Blues. But their coach came back to Philly because he was loved in Philly. And we'll talk about it next hour, and we will be joined by the guy who runs the Jack's New Year's Brigade. See right here, it says Play Gloria. Yeah,
Craig Berube was it was fun. It was fun going out to the whatever that restaurant was that we went to.
It was out in the suburbs, but it was a great spot.
It was a great spot.
And we did our show live from there.
Yeah.
And who did the Blues beat that year, Dean? Who did the St. Louis Blues beat to win the Stanley Cup back in 2019? You know who it was? We'll tell you next hour if you don't know. Meanwhile, we have some football news today. I mentioned that the Philadelphia Eagles, by the way, have now lost two of their offensive linemen who were drafted in the same year in the 2020 draft. And backup guys, but Sua Opeta timed with Tampa Bay yesterday. And then Jack Driscoll, who was a fourth-round draft pick out of Auburn in 2020, he too has moved on as a free agent. He's joining the Miami Dolphins. So Jack Driscoll to Miami, Sua Opeta to Tampa Bay. Again, important guys because you have backup linemen who could play multiple positions. And so the interesting thing about this situation is that the only player, now the Eagles in 2020 had 10 draft picks. They drafted 10 players in that draft. And you know who the only player left from that 2020 draft who is still on the Eagles roster, Robin? Let me give you a little. I'm gonna put the music here.
Oh,
because I need you to do.
We need to go. Is what we need to do.
Here, who was the only player from the 2020 Eagles draft that remains on the roster of the 10 players drafted that year by your team, your town? You're Philadelphia Eagles, Robin.
Joe Quills is guessing Mailata.
That is incorrect. And not offensive linemen. I'm talking about all draft picks. They had 10 draft picks. They weren't all offensive linemen. I can't believe you don't know this. You know who it is?
Who is it?
Jalen Hurts.
Nuh-uh.
Jalen Hurts is the last man standing.
Chris McQuaid actually just got it.
Exactly.
In
the last man standing. They drafted 10 guys, and 9 of them are gone.
Wow.
And that's what happens. You got players. By the way, these guys weren't stars. Jack Driscoll is a nice player from Auburn, and he was a backup guy. And you have to have backups. And the Eagles did re-sign Matt Hennessy, who brings a nice case of bourbon with him. Hennessy is what? Cognac, isn't it?
Yes.
It's a cognac.
Oui.
Hen dog. We love the hen dog. So they signed him back. He was a third round pick a couple of years ago from Temple. So he plays center and left guard. And so that's what's going on, the latest with the Philadelphia Eagles. And it looks like the situation with their edge rusher who wants a new deal, it doesn't appear that's going to happen. So we'll keep you up to date on that. Everything else going on. And in the 5 o'clock hour, we will break down the NBA too. No Giannis tonight against the Boston Celtics for the Milwaukee Bucks. We'll cover the NBA, basketball, anything you need. We got it right here. Stick around to Tony Bruno Sports Network.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Souvenir Snow Globe Maker.
Mr. Souvenir Snow Globe Maker.
Scoffing at Mother Nature, you bring snowy wonderment to miniature Mauis, tiny Tampas, and itty-bitty Bahamas.
It's a small, small world.
Sure, Rome wasn't built in a day, but mini snow globe Rome was.
A fever in Lee.
Today's forecast for mini Rio de Janeiro, massive flooding, followed by snow.
Can't stop it now.
So crack open an ice-cold Bud Light, champion of the Chotsky, because you make everyone's world a little smaller and a whole lot snowier.
Mr. Souvenir Snow Globe Man.
Bud Light beer, and I suppose.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Supermarket Free Sample Guy.
Mr. Supermarket Free Sample Guy.
Though man dreads few things more than a trip to the supermarket, you offer us hope and sometimes a free mini weenie.
I love that freebie weenie.
What exactly do you have? Aerosol cheese products? Deep fried morsels? Who cares? If it's on a toothpick and it's free, it could be plutonium and we'd eat it.
It's all good, baby.
For a guy wearing oven mitts and an apron, you're all right.
You're a star.
So crack open an ice-cold Bud Light Titan of the toothpick, because you put the free in free.
I broke four generations of family tradition with five little words. Ma, I want to make perfume. Getting my business off the ground was a full-time job.
So I made Barbara's new sidekick count, guaranteeing 100% accurate filing and a maximum refund.
Make your moves. We'll make them count. Intuit TurboTax, 100% accuracy guaranteed.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've been waiting, and now it's here. TBSN, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Make some noise!
The Tony Bruno Sports Network. Download the app, tell your friends, the game is on. TBSN.
Music, please.
Beautiful. I hear you, baby.
Let it roll.
It's the most tremendous new musical experience.
Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Are we rolling? Can you hear me now?
Yep, ready?
All right, here we go.
3, 2, 1.
You know me. I've been around forever.
I know him. I know him.
This is the Tony Bruno Show. Here he is, the godfather of sports radio. Here's Tony Bruno.
Ah, yes. Welcome. It is the happy hour portion of the program. We welcome all of you watching now on No Filter Network, along with the rest of you watching us all over the world, listening all over the world on the Tony Bruno Sports Network app. Don't forget, download the app, and then you can hear us anywhere. And we're on every day from 3 to 6 Eastern Time, and catch the show. A lot of fun today. We had the great Tim Brando on talking about the NCAA tournament, which kicks up again tonight, the NIT. We got NBA. We got all kinds of things. Baseball started in Seoul, Korea with the Dodgers and the Padres. But one of the stories that I saw last night, and I couldn't believe it, because, you know, I don't cover St. Louis media, but I saw the story that was on the St. Louis Post-Dispatch about a story that we followed very closely. And we have to go back now to 2019, Robin. We were living in South Philly. We would walk to this great bar on Moyamensing Avenue, and it was called Jack's New Year's NYB. Jack's NYB, which is Jack's New Year's Bar or Brigade. And the man who put this all together is a guy who was a friend of the show. And I didn't even know if they were still there, you know, because it's been a while. But this guy, Brendan Armstrong, is the guy who put this together, and he's got to be as thrilled as anybody else, including the family and friends of Layla Anderson in St. Louis. Brendan, when did you find out about the unbelievable turn of events and how this young lady went from an 8-year-old girl who was basically dealing with a life-threatening illness to now actually being a hockey player and scoring a goal and winning a cup in her own league in St. Louis?
Hey, Tony, great to be on with you again and to reconnect after all these years. You know, we still have a group chat. It's for the New Year's Brigade, the Jacks, NYB, and those guys have been real active. I haven't been as active at the club myself recently, just moved out of the city, but they've been hosting some Blues fans. They were there not too long ago for the Blues Flyers, so they've had connections there. And Mike Montecavo, he kind of keeps it all together. He's the one keeping us all posted on different events that happen. And it's great to hear, and it's great to see her progress, and she's getting better. And it's been fun to be a part of it from that side.
Yeah, because people are wondering, why would a bar in Philly, you know, which normally has Flyers fans in there, and why would that happen? Why would because a St. Louis Blue player came in there, right?
Once a couple of them, right?
A couple of them came into the bar, and then everybody was watching the games together. And then obviously the Flyers were eliminated, so they basically adopted the St. Louis Blues team that year, right?
Well, that was So those guys hosted the Eagles playoff game. That was the double doink game,
right?
And there were some connections there through some friends, and a couple of the Blues came in that night. It was a Sunday night, the double doink victory over the Bears. And, you know, Eddie Renzi played Gloria, the song Gloria, and, you know, just kind of took off from there. And then it progressed. The Blues beat the Flyers the next game.
Mm-hmm.
And then they went on this incredible run, and they stayed in touch with, again, some managers at our club, and next thing you know, things progressed, and it's in March, and they're winning, and then it gets to April, and then it kind of just took on a life of its own. I thought it was a really cool story, just being how unique it was, and that's really how it happened. I mean, it just kept rolling, and if you remember that series, I think every series the Blues played in, I think went to 7 games, so there was a lot of a lot of excitement, you know, and then it just took off. I mean, and then the Cardinals were in town to play the Phillies, so the St. Louis Cardinals media was there, so we had to, you know, work through that as well, and that was real fun. And you know, folks like yourself and other local broadcasters would come by, and it just became a really cool story.
It really was, and you know, we always talk about Philly fans. You know, they hate everybody and all this other stuff. But being there, I mean, it was a fun vibe. You know, here we are rooting for the Blues, not because of just the St. Louis Blues and a couple of Blues players that came in there, and then the Play Gloria thing started, but the fact that the young lady, Layla, in St. Louis was 8 years old, and things did not look good for her health-wise. I mean, the disease that she had was a rare life-threatening autoimmune disease, and it attacked her brain. So a lot of people didn't know whether she was even going to make it to survive, and now here we find out yesterday in the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. In fact, we have the video of her playing a game. So now she's playing hockey at the age of 15 on a team that just played in a tournament. She scored a goal, and they won a cup. They won their local cup for that age group of 15-year-old girls, and to see her out there after we saw her back when she was 8 years old in St. Louis in 1999 is a modern-day miracle and one of those feel-good stories. There she is skating out and after scoring a goal, and they welcomed her. Now look at her. 15 years old, she was basically near death. She had basically had very little chance to survive this ailment, and it's just an amazing story. And Joe Buck, I went on her Instagram today, and everybody's like, just besides themselves. It's just an unbelievable story, and we're so happy to see this. Because, you know, we always talk about say a prayer for me or hey, send some thoughts and prayers for people when they're sick. People ask me all the time. I ask people when my mom was sick. I mean, that's just something you do. It's positive vibes. It's not about being super religious. It's about being positive. And that experience in South Philly with people, and as you mentioned it, news cameras, news crews were coming from all over, and we're standing outside drinking and singing Gloria every time the Blues scored a goal.
Actually, Tony, I have that really quick. Let me just show you a video of us at the Jack's New Year's Brigade. Hold on, let me.
Yeah, we were there partying, man. We know everybody had their cameras rolling. It was a rocking scene, okay. Man. I can't believe it was that long ago.
So this is us.
Here we are.
And I think that this was, I mean, if you're, it was loud, it was awesome.
It was packed, inside and outside, man.
It was fantastic. It was such a great time, and we can't thank you enough for inviting us down there.
And it wasn't even a Blues bar. I mean, it's a Philly bar, you know, and then it became a Blues bar. That's one of the things I'll never forget because, you know, when the Phillies won the World Series for the first time, I was there, the Sixers, the Flyers. I was lucky to live. Then the Eagles Super Bowl, we were there in Minnesota. But, to see a city embrace another team and rally around a young girl who was really, really in bad shape and then them win the cup. And then, of course, the coach came back to Philly with the Stanley Cup. Now, did you go up to that event when the cup came to Philadelphia?
Yeah, they did that in New Hope. I didn't go to that one, but I did go to St. Louis to the parade. We were there for the weekend, and that was really fun. We had a lot of support there in St. Louis for that weekend, and we were at that parade, and that was a great memory for sure. The whole thing was just, like you said, real positive, and, that was great. I mean, that was a great time, but a bunch of us went to St. Louis for the parade, and the events around that, and that was a really fun couple days in St. Louis.
Yeah, that's what's great about living in a city where, you know, there's fans are just really into everything. Philly's a passionate sports town. You know, St. Louis, they didn't really have a lot of success, and to see them win and to see them rally around this young girl, it's just, you talk about perfect endings, and now she's playing hockey. She's scoring goals. So see, she's not one of these sympathy cases. She's out there competing every single night. And, you know, that's what we want to see. We want to see anybody who has a disease. And obviously, a lot of people don't make it. But when we see somebody who was a young girl and you saw her, and the players would go to her hospital room, they would bring her stuff, the Blues players, the other out-of-town players, players from all over the world, hockey players from the entire world were rallying around Layla. And it was a great, great story. It was just phenomenal, and you guys did a great job there, man. And that's the part about living in South Philly and walking around. You can walk to a bar, hang outside on a June night, and just everybody was feeling really, really good. Even though the local teams weren't doing much, you know, that was a great, great time to be around in the city of Philadelphia, watching how fans rally around other people who are going through issues and rallying around a young girl. And now here I still have the shirt, man. I still have my Jacks. I still have my Play Gloria shirt on. I have it. Oh, people give away their shirts. I'm saving this one, man, because this is a special one.
That's a great shirt. Yeah, we still see them around.
Well, Brendan, it's great. So you're still living in Philly, right?
No, he said he moved out.
In the Philly area. But okay. I'm not right around the neighborhood as much anymore. But, you know, obviously still in touch with those guys that worked in the city and all that. It's great, man. It's been fun.
Great story. Well, Brendan, really appreciate it, man. Thanks for inviting us. Thanks for letting us know. And I was happy to be there on those nights and just soaking in the joy. People were joyful. When you see people happy, and it's not just about alcohol, when people are genuinely happy and get behind a cause or a sports team, even if it's an out-of-town team, I mean, it just makes you feel good as a human being, and that's what this is all about. You know, there's so much negative shit going on in the world, but to be able to see there and be a part of that, which we really didn't have anything to do with, but we were just there feeling the vibe and being happy with people around us who were happy. It's good to be around happy people instead of, you know, angry people all the time, man. And there's so much anger and hate in the world. That was a special, special time.
So, man. Tony, just for Brendan, as we say goodbye to him, for old time's sake.
You want me to crank it up, Robin?
Crank it up.
I got it. I have it in my system still.
Oh,
I'll play a little Gloria for you, man. Gloria. Now, do you still play that song?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Beautiful, man. Beautiful.
Or maybe you won't.
I have it in here. I put it in here, Robin. And now I can't find it, damn it.
Tony Bruno. I'll play it.
Go ahead, hit it. Hit it.
I have to
put it in here. Where the hell did it go?
I don't know, Tony Bruno.
I have all these songs in here. Here it is. I got it.
Okay.
Crank it. Laura Branigan. Here we go.
Yep.
Good stuff. Everybody, one more time. Play Gloria wherever you are and think of young. Kayla.
Layla.
Why do I keep calling her Kayla? It's Layla Anderson. Follow her on Instagram. You'll find her.
Oh,
Layla.
My God. It's just awesome to see her.
All the athletes and hockey players and people from entertainment and from all over the world, just regular people going on her Instagram feed. Layla, I think it's Layla with a couple of numbers after it. Layla Anderson. And spelled L-A-I-L-A.
Well, if you look up Layla Anderson and blues, you'll find her, all of her Instagram and Facebook and all that. And it's just awesome to see.
Exactly. Brendan, appreciate the time, man. Those were great times. And I'm glad you got a chance to pop back on and relive it with us and enjoy it.
Great.
Thanks,
great
brother.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brendan. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give him a roaring round of applause. Brendan Armstrong, bringing it strong. Why do I have to give myself one of those for what?
Because you couldn't find the song.
Oh, I just put it in there. It's on a separate page. I made a separate page so I can play Gloria today without having to have you go in and find it. I'll give myself one of those. But I'm emotional. I wasn't even thinking about playing it until we got on the phone. So then I wanted to make sure I got all the facts straight.
Oh.
And we got it straight. And we have the video to prove it. And then we have the video of her now winning a cup of her own.
It's awesome.
So if Timothy Philip McDevitt wants to give me one of those, I'll gladly take one of those to get a story accurate. And
bum, 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 bum.
Give me one of those. Give me one of those.
If you can find that one.
I don't deserve it. I mean, come on.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
Well, but you have to turn Gloria off first.
Let's crank it up, Robin. I don't want Gloria to end here.
Tony, we have so many stories, and
I know.
We also have Luigi coming up for more more sports news.
Well, he's a big Sporty Spice fan,
yes,
I think,
he is.
But back in the day.
Which one was Sporty Spice?
She was the chick that wore like a soccer uniform.
Okay.
Did she ever, because obviously she wasn't the most popular one, right? It was Posh Spice because she was married to David Beckham, right?
But she wasn't married to him yet.
No, but David Beckham.
But she
Beckham,
was one of the more popular.
He had choice
popular.
Of the litter, so to speak.
And then the other one, she was a redhead. She was really popular, too.
I don't remember the Spice Girls. But I love their songs, though. My favorite, what's your favorite Spice? Not I'll Tell You What I Want, What I Really, Really Want.
That one's catchy. It's hard not to.
No, but their best song was a down-tempo number, Robin.
Really?
And the video was phenomenal. They were in a street in New York City. I don't even need to get the sticks out for this one. They were in New York and the traffic's going by. Two becomes one. That's what it is. When two become one.
Let's see.
That's the Spice. That's, to me, that's my favorite Spice Girls jam. Look it up, Robin. Look up the Spice Girl jams. Yeah, watch this video. Do you have the video? This was so well done, too. They were in New York on an island. In the middle of the street. Actually, it's all over New York. But then the cars are going by around them. Don't you remember the song?
There's Sporty Spice. I don't remember this one.
Crank it. Well, you'll hear the bridge when we take it to the bridge. Not to Ben Franklin,
okay,
not
I'm
to Brooklyn.
Oh, yeah, I sort of remember this one. That one, the redhead, she was really popular. And then Baby Spice, I remember her.
Two become one, yeah.
Okay, that's boring.
That's a great song, Robin. How dare you? Everybody's happy, and all of a sudden you become cranky with the Spice Girls.
Sorry.
Come on. Speaking of Spice, we'll have a Spice update on this show today.
Should we just talk about it right now? Did you hear about it? I mean,
yeah, that's a good transition. We went from the Spice Girls to Yes, and it's one of my favorite spices because it's a spice that I use, and we have the actual nuts to grind the spice instead of buying the one in the jar.
Yes.
You know, when you buy a lot of spices, especially nuts that you grind, it's always better when you grind them fresh, even pepper.
I mean, we've always used nutmeg, but we really started to appreciate nutmeg when we learned how to make painkillers.
Painkillers, the drink that you get in the Virgin Islands. Yes.
Tropical drink ever.
And if you go to what's the bar in Joost Van Dyke in the Dutch West Indies? Soggy Dollar Bar.
Yes.
And you go up and you swim up to the beach. The water's perfect. And you go up and you're supposed to, it used to be they would hand them a $10 bill.
Right.
And then they would hang it up on a clothesline. But it was an outdoor bar. It was sand. It was dirty.
That bar has been around so long that it used to be dollar bills.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, you know, they take credit cards because you can't buy a round of drinks with like a 10. You're not going to carry a $100 bill swimming. So you give them a credit card. But then they make the drink. And then on the bar, there's nutmeg all over the place because they have the nutmeg nuts. And then at the end, they just grate the fresh nutmeg on top.
It's so awesome.
We found out that stupid kids are doing stupid stuff with nutmeg. Let's go to your nutmeg desk and your correspondent, a woman who can grate a nutmeg and bust some nuts better than anyone I know, Miss Robin.
If you are...
Can you bring my sounder up, Robin, so I can play the breaking news sound?
Yes.
Okay.
If you are one of those stupid TikTok must do everything like on TikTok, or if you have children that might be one of those stupid idiots, you might want to be careful if you see them with little vials of nutmeg. Not cocaine. I mean, you want to be careful for that too. But nutmeg, which might seem very innocuous, and it tastes great in soups and stuff like that, and in pumpkin pie. But
yeah, it's a great spice.
It's a great spice. It comes from Indonesia. But apparently, nutmeg can make you high.
Make you high tonight.
1 teaspoon. Like if you take 1 or 2 teaspoons.
Now, don't say it can't. It does make you high, but it's not in a good way.
No.
It's not something you should be doing. Do not snort. Now, Parmesan cheese, I learned from Hunter Biden.
Snorting it. They're ingesting it.
Well, it's the same thing.
Yeah, no, but I mean, it's
what are they doing? Putting it on their tongue? How are they ingesting it? I think they're snorting it, Robin.
No, they're ingesting it. Two teaspoons. 2 teaspoons full.
So they're putting 2 teaspoons
and they're just,
of
they're
nutmeg in their mouth.
Now, apparently this has been a thing.
In prisons.
Yes.
Because you can't get good shit in prisons. Unless you got somebody with a key or a file or put in your pie of your birthday cake when you bring it to jail.
A nurse said that I took care of a kid years ago at the hospital for nutmeg intoxication. It was the first time I'd ever heard of it. Started in jails. But they have internet, so I'm sure that that's where they learned it. This has been a thing for years. It's a psychoactive, but not in a fun way. You get the worst hangover in your life for a 10-minute high, another one added.
But it's not a good high. Don't try this. Do not do it. It could kill you.
It is, and it's a narcotic and hallucinogenic properties, and it's could potentially be fatal. So... do not do this.
And as I mentioned, I learned about Parmesan cheese out of the carpets when Hunter Biden said this publicly. This isn't her say. You know, when he was a drug addict and he was doing coke, if he couldn't find any, he would sniff Parmesan cheese out of the carpets. That's the point was he wasn't really.
Yeah.
But when you're that desperate and you need a fix, that's what he said he would do.
Well,
but I'd snort Parmesan cheese. I'll have it spread all over me because it's not going to kill me. But I love nutmeg.
People have been accidentally overdosing on the
nutmeg
for about 400 years because a lot of
people
think,
try different things.
Well, here's the thing,
especially if it's native, if something that grows,
people
smoke it.
Ooh, a little bit tastes great. Let me take a lot of it, and no, that's just stupid. So It is not a good high. Tell your kids, don't do this. It might sound like it's, oh, yeah, it's the pumpkin pie spice. It's so cool. No, don't do it. An 8-year-old died after eating 2 seeds of pumpkin. So that's like teaspoons. And a 55-year-old also died from acute nutmeg poisoning. So
yeah,
don't do it.
No, when we come back from our break.
Ignore the nutmeg challenge on TikTok.
It's a boring song. This,
thank you,
Spice
Donald
Girls?
Harrison. It was a boring song.
No, it's a good chill song. When you want to relax, there's no hooch around. Dean's posting his this year, UConn, Houston, Purdue, Arizona, North Carolina, Auburn, Creighton, Marquette. Yeah, what about him? Yes, Wayne Atkinson. Looks like I picked the wrong week to start sniffing nutmeg. I'm going to get some nutmeg. We have a break because I want to make a painkiller now, Robin.
Ooh, can you make me one too?
Do we have the do we have the ingredients?
I don't know.
I may demonstrate. Well, you know what? Let's do it tomorrow for Thursday.
Okay.
Tomorrow I will prepare on this show because you've been good boyses and girlses this week, and because I'm feeling good about life and everything that it offers, even though the United States keeps dropping down in the happiest countries on earth. It's sad. But I'm going to help make that quotient go back up where everybody feels good again.
Our
without
goal
drugs or alcohol
on
or tobacco.
TBSN with all the shows is to make you, our lovely audience, happier. We want to spread happiness.
Exactly right. Now, Sally Field is trending now, so of course I have to go in there.
We don't want there to be any bad
news. No, but that's what happens when you see a trend and you try to find out and you hope they didn't die. Isn't that what happens when you look on social media? Sally Field is trending.
And then, yeah, and then you're like, oh, no, please let them still be alive. And then you find out that it's, you know, it's their birthday or...
I don't think it's a birthday. Yeah, yesterday, you know whose birthday it was? 69 years old yesterday.
Who?
I played the video. I pulled a video of him yesterday. Bruce Willis.
Oh, yes.
Bruce Willis, who obviously is not in good shape, and he's, you know, his family is around him because he's... You know, he's pretty close to dying now, sad to say.
Yeah.
But yesterday was his 69th birthday, and they did post a video, his family did.
I have this.
But this was a video at a roast that he did a couple of years ago.
Yes, this is a couple of years ago, and it is the best self-introduction video ever.
Now, Bruce Willis was being roasted at the Friars Club, and I believe our good buddy was hosting it that night, who lives in L.A. and is a Philly guy. The guy who did the court,
Florentine?
The comedy. No. The legendary Philly comic.
Dom
Herrera.
Yeah, Dom Herrera.
Dom Herrera was hosting this, but you don't see that. I don't have the whole roast. But this is where Bruce Willis goes up after everybody roasts him, and then he gets the final say. And this is a clip. There is profanity in it, but it means, you know, hey, he's the guy who said yippee-ki-yay, and this is Bruce Willis. Few years ago when they roasted him at the Friars Club.
Nothing can keep me down. I've been attacked by terrorists, asteroids, film critics, music critics, restaurant critics, divorce lawyers, male pattern baldness, and none of it stopped me because I am still Bruce fucking Willis.
That's freaking awesome.
God, what an amazing talent. And it's sad to see he's not going to be with us very much longer. That's why you got to enjoy every day. Nobody knows when they're going to go. And you see people like Bruce Willis and other members of your family who start to losing it, whether it's dementia or whether it's Parkinson's disease, to see the deterioration of your loved ones. You know, and then you just don't, you want them to snap out of it. You know, you just think that, okay, now they're going to snap out of it. And sadly, most of the time they don't. So the research is still going on. But to see the greats like Bruce Willis and so many other people who aren't celebrities start fading away as they get older,
with
it's sad.
Dementia-related type diseases. Mm-hmm. It's very sad. It's one of the cruelest diseases out there, whether it's normal dementia, Alzheimer's, or the kind that Bruce Willis has.
Bruce Willis, 69 years. Bobby Orr, 76 today, Robin.
Wow.
76 years old. And people are ripping this one guy, and I'm glad, because there's this one guy, his name is, he used to work at NBC, and he promoted the fact that he works at NBC, but he's a whack job, and he should be called out. And his name is Mike Sington, S-I-N-G-T-O-N. Senior executive at NBC Universal, retired. Hollywood's ultimate insider, entertainment, pop culture, and lifestyle expert, media personality. He's in Los Angeles, and he has like 132,000 followers. And he posted something today, and he addressed it now. So he posted this morning that Baron Trump, Donald Trump's son, turned 18 today. So he posted, Donald Trump, Baron Trump is 18 today, fair game. And then, of course, he got absolutely besieged. So now he has to go to Newsweek to explain it while he deleted his account temporarily. So he writes, Baron Trump fair game comment enrages Republicans. That's his response. So it enrages Republicans. No, it doesn't enrage anybody else. So he gets this crap writer named Rachel Dobkin from Newsweek, which should be spelled N-E-W-S-W-E-A-K. And then this guy goes into this whole thing. I posted he was fair game now, meaning as an adult, he's fair game for criticism from the press. Well, you may be right. He's an adult. He's a legal age person.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not why he did it. He did it because he's a triggered loser. Because he's part of that Hollywood elite game, especially at NBC, where they're all in the tank. You know, to trash Trump and good, keep doing it. But if you don't want to get ripped and ratioed for things that you say on social media, then don't post things that you know you're going to get profiled because all your buddies at Newsweek and NBC are going to come into your defense and some woman named Rachel Dobkin, weekend reporter. Rachel Dobkin, weekend reporter at Newsweek. Losers. Absolute losers.
We will be right
back. Speaking of losers, but no, Luigi is not a loser.
No, he's not.
He's our boy, and he's coming up next. We're going to have some fun again. Follow me.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno of the Tony Bruno's.
Enter this promo code here for a chance to win stuff from all of the ads. DoorDash-all-the-ads-2024-promo code. Dash. DoorDash can DoorDash pretty much anything. Dash a new Kia EV9, Dash peanut butter M&Ms, Dash Dinamita, Dash Mountain Dew Baja Blast, Dash BMW i5, Dash Popeye's chicken, Dash YouTube TV, Dash Oreo, Dash Dove, Dash Live, Dash Love, Dash... I am not going to read all of this. It's a very long promo code. Just enter it at this website. Oh, and there's more.
Sheriff, I got this.
Protecting your business from cyber attacks can be unrelenting. Today's adversaries move fast. CrowdStrike moves faster. CrowdStrike, we stop breaches.
Whoa, whoa, whoa! We help you?
I have a delivery for Athena.
Twist on it?
Yeah. Cream on the right, we'll let him in.
Oh! Welcome to Troy.
Oh, thank you.
Should we report this?
I just twisted on it. This never happened.
So every little detail about our family will be on TV? Who would watch that?
All right, let me twist on it.
Hope you can keep up.
Wait a minute. We could have been twisting on everything this whole time.
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Blondie, see how I talk that right up, Robin? That's you know, you can't teach that.
No.
It's an internal, what's the rhythm? The circadian rhythm?
Circadian rhythm.
I saw them last week. They were opening down at the Tiki Bar here in Fort Myers. Anyway, Luigi's going to call in here. Or is he?
He is supposed to. He's on the road, supposedly. So he's going to call as soon as he can.
Mm-hmm.
In the meantime, Tony, Yes. I think you still had some stuff that you needed to go over, right?
Yeah, I gave you the... we got to do the Jim Harbaugh story, Robin. Remember that?
Yes.
We gave you the snorting nutmeg. We gave you the happiest countries on earth. Obviously, we're getting ready for another big night of basketball, NIT games deep into the night. Two more NCAA first round games with a couple of teams that obviously, you know, are not common. Grambling against Montana State tonight. That's the early game on, and I heard my boy, the great Greek god, who we had on a couple of weeks ago, Spiro Dedis, doing those games last night from Dayton, Ohio, on True TV. So tonight you'll have Grambling against Montana State and Colorado against Boise State. Those two games tonight in the NCAA, and then the field of 64 will be set, and they'll start playing again Thursday and Friday and through the weekend. But opening day in baseball. But we have a Jim Harbaugh. We talked about it yesterday. Jim Harbaugh, there were various videos of him having a yard sale at his home in Michigan. Now, we all know Jim Harbaugh is now the Los Angeles Chargers coach, and he's going to move to California where he lived and he grew up. He went to Stanford. His family's all out there. He's not unfamiliar with California, but he doesn't have a home there. So his home in Michigan is obviously he's going to sell it and then move to Los Angeles soon.
Correct.
And so people were talking about, oh, he had all the snow globes and everything
else. Yesterday, right? We talked about the fact that he had a big garage sale.
And people were saying, why didn't he just donate the stuff, right?
They were family.
Ripping him and saying, why is he selling stuff in his backyard? Well, you now have the definitive answer, Robin. So this is a Jim Harbaugh yard sale RV update combo mambo.
Correct.
Let's go to your correspondent, Miss Robin, with the latest news.
Now, so we mentioned,
I think Luigi's on the line. Let's bring him aboard, because he's a big yard sale guy also, and he joins us wanting to know what really happened with the Jim Harbaugh yard sale. Luigi, have you been following this saga?
No, but I love buying shit that people don't want anymore. So, yeah,
the people, Luigi, listen to this. The people that went to the Harbaugh yard sale might have gotten more than you normally would get at a garage sale because they are downsizing big time. They have a huge house, and the Harbaugh's Jim has told his wife that rather than going and purchasing or renting another house right away in L.A., he wants the entire family to live in an RV at a oceanside trailer park.
Oh, how about that? You talk about down with the peeps, man. I mean, you know, well, people like me and Robin, we lived in an RV for a year. How about Jim Harbaugh going RVing on the beach in SoCal, bro?
Yeah, baby.
But listen, I'm gonna have a yard sale soon too because I'm getting evicted. Totally different fucking reason.
Oh,
Jim,
come on!
Time,
now, as you know, Luigi, when we moved back from California, you helped us move our furniture from a storage unit into our apartment in Dockside, and then helped us move it back to South Philly where we had no room for it.
So you're used to taking all of our
shit and moving it from one place to the next.
Yeah, pretty much. I'm a pro at this. But let the record show, Tony. I want the people to know that I accomplished a feat that not many are able to do. I folded a king-size mattress in half.
Yes, you did.
Do you know the amount of strength and fortitude that takes? Now, I've gotten a hernia from it, but at the same time, it happened. You know what I mean?
Now, remember, this is the real, this is not the new ones where you buy it and it's ready, and then you just release it. Old school.
It's not a California king, man. That was old school, man. Mm-hmm.
It was, and you did, and brought it upstairs, and then, like, a year later, we said, by the way, we bought a new mattress. Can you help fold it again and get it downstairs?
Yeah. The word cocksucker never exited my mouth.
Oh, come on, man. Come on, man.
I just got my hair cut earlier today. A female barber, Tone. I sat down in the chair and I said, just do whatever you think I need. She added 3 inches to me. I mean, believe it or not, that's I got nothing on material.
Now did you get a trim? Did you get the razor cut where they do the box cut, you know, the razor? Did you get the lines in the side?
I always get trim, man. I got a problem.
Well, trim is
good.
No,
I just got cleaned up a little bit. No, I cut 2 inches, almost 3 inches off the length of my hair, man. It was down to my bottom lip, and now it's like right around my nose.
I need to see pictures, man. How are you not doing this on camera, man? Seriously, bro.
Because I don't need the world to see how I live.
Come on, man.
I don't know. I don't post stuff just to post. I post my artwork, man. That's what I post.
Where's the objects they are? Where's our painting you said you were going to make for the new home?
I sold it.
You and Hunter Biden, did you get $500,000 like Hunter Biden gets for his paintings?
No, but I heard you telling me that, you know, he's snorting Parmesan cheese off the carpet. I'm more of a Locatelli kind of guy, so I got a little extra kick to it.
That's cheaper stuff. But, I mean, you get the Parmigiano Reggiano. It doesn't get any better than that, does it?
I like the Locatelli, though, man. I do. I like the Locatelli.
I like it, too, man. It's cheese. I'm a cheeses freak, man.
Is there any cheese that you don't like?
Seriously,
like...
From under. I'm not a big from under cheese guy. I'll tell you that right now.
I walked right into that one. Yeah.
I don't know if there is a cheese. Tony, you like the stinky cheeses too, right?
Some of them, yeah. I like the ones with the
Do you remember
when it's brie and all
Luigi
that other crap.
Went to Luigi, you went to the Amish market one day and you came back with some of the best blue cheese.
Yes.
Yeah, it was a Roquefort. It was
yes.
a Roquefort, but it was I forget what the hell variety it was, but it was French, mm-hmm. and like there was blue crystals in that blue cheese, Robin.
Yeah.
Where like they had like that little snap to them.
Yeah,
it was
Stilton.
The cleanest taste
Stilton
possible. So good.
Blue. It was Stilton.
Stilton.
Yeah, Stilton. It was actually a British blue Stilton Royal blue
good.
Cheese.
That's
oh,
some good shit right there, man. That's some good stuff.
Yeah, good shit. $26 an ounce.
Well, it should, man.
Yeah.
Incredible. I know.
Not Velveeta. No, Luigi's not a Velveeta. He's not a Whiz guy. Mm. Are you a Whiz guy?
Well, I'm a Without.
Without. No, Without's onions. By the way, you saw skinny Joey Merlino is now going to take over that cheesesteak place right under the Walt Whitman Bridge area there when you go down south on Broad Street toward the stadium complex. It was talk of the town.
Right by the gas station.
Yeah, there's a gas station that's like $7 a gallon there, right? Yeah. And it's an Amoco, I think.
Oh, I ran by it today. That's what I run past that all the time whenever I go on like
yeah.
my five
so
or six
it was talk of the town when Donovan McNabb. Remember, Donovan McNabb used to go in there and get a cheesesteak before the game because he wanted free cheesesteak. So he figured if he told the guy he had great cheesesteaks and everybody knew it, they got good business, and that's a smart
move.
Well,
it was part of the town. Now it was Ace of Steaks.
Mm-hmm.
It was called Ace of Steaks.
Were they from? We played their song yesterday. We played a little Ace of Steaks yesterday.
Yeah,
I saw the sign.
Here's another baby.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Sorry, man. I love it. I love it. But yeah, so what? Joey Merlino is gonna resurrect that place?
Yes, skinny Joey's Merlino, but. They only have seats in the back of the room where you only can look forward. There's no walking in and turning your back to the counter. I mean, you just don't want to do that down there. You know what I mean?
No, I understand. Totally. You want the mob table. Every table is the mob table.
Exactly
you
right,
everybody
man.
Everybody coming in. That's the way you want it, man. That's the way you want it, dude. The problem is that every time the waiter comes up to ask somebody what they want, nobody says anything.
Exactly.
That's the fucking problem. So, nobody says anything.
I just like going to restaurants that I always go into, and then the waiter comes over, and I go, the normal, the regular? Mushu. And then he goes back, brings me a cocktail, brings me a bottle of wine. You know, when I got to have a problem with the menu and stuff, I don't want to deal with that. You know what I'm saying?
You know what I got, Tone? You know what I've managed to acquire over the past few years? One of the greatest, walk into a place and, you know, you just get treated right kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very low-key hookup. I got the hookup at the deli counter at the Acme Tone.
No!
Whenever I walk in, it doesn't matter how many people are in front of me, walks right up and goes, what can I get you, Weege?
Oh,
no matter what.
Now, is it the dude on the Acme on Pass Yonk Avenue down there, that Acme that was our neighborhood?
Pass Yonk, yeah, man. There's,
love that
yep,
Acme.
Those people back there are fantastic.
Yeah.
And if they're listening, I need a 3/4 pound of chicken salad, please, immediately.
Nah, you don't want a chicken salad. Don't buy anything with mayonnaise.
No,
you know chicken salad, man. You got to
just
get it.
No, I like the chicken salad. Just keep it. They keep it fresh, man. But I mean, Charlie, you could go to a deli counter and you could waste 12 years of your life just waiting for a half a pound of ham and a half pound of cheese. You know that. So to be able to just walk in, and as soon as you walk past the bananas, they give you the, hey, what do you need?
What do you want?
And they say, now serving number one. They're pointing at me, pal.
Damn right. I used to get the same treatment. The guy in there knew me. He says, the normal? I said, yeah, mushroom. Give me a little quarter pound. Robin didn't want to get more than a quarter pound. I'm like, why are you getting a quarter pound? You got to get a half a pound.
Four slices.
I know.
It's four slices.
I'm like, Robin, I eat cheese like Jesus of Nazareth doesn't have as many cheese in me as I do. You got to get a half. And if you look up when they had it on sale, remember it'd be like $8.99 a pound? Give me a pound. Put it in two packages. Put it in a plastic bag.
No, I don't like. I don't like the people that are that take 2 hours. Like, I want it thin. Or some people they go chip it. Can you chip it?
Chip it.
Like this guy goes. He goes. My grandson will only eat the ham if it's chipped. I'm like, well, then your grandson ain't fucking eating. I'm like, chip the ham. I'm like, at that point, why don't you just run a cube of spam through a food processor and let him eat that?
Yeah, exactly. Get spam and then crush it up and throw it in a plate and say, eat this, you little bastard. And by the way, you know, when Meatball goes into that Acme, you know what she says, right?
Everybody must eat. Well, of course.
Exactly. By the way, we have one of my followers on social media always reports on the Wawa on 7700 block of Frankfurt Avenue getting, like, robbed twice a day, every day up there.
Yeah, it's a mess, man.
What is going on up there, man?
It is a war zone. Tony, I can't call it, dude. It's a war zone. I mean, it's an absolute war zone. Snyder Avenue, like Broad and Snyder, it's like Baghdad after 6 o'clock at night.
That's the old neighborhood, man.
It's a mess, man. And you know what's worse? Not what's worse. You know what? It's gonna get worse because you know what's happening.
What's happening?
It's getting nicer out, Tony.
Oh, yeah.
It's getting nicer outside.
Yeah.
So when it's nicer outside, there's more people outside, and they stay out longer, and more stuff happens. Like I say, the crime rate is through the roof right now in Philadelphia.
How just dare you say that? That's months. You know, that's fear-mongering. That's what I hear from – oh, that's fear-mongering. That stuff's not really happening. You still there, Louis?
I'm here.
Okay, I just didn't
want to – I'm here. I'm just listening to you. I'm letting you talk.
I don't want to talk anymore. I've talked enough.
You don't want to talk anymore? I guess I'll take it from here.
You're not done yet, Tony. I'm sorry.
No, I don't want to interrupt. Luigi's on a when he gets on a roll, I let him go. I stand back. What was the movie? He's on a roll. Animal House, right? He's on a roll. Let him go.
Yeah, he's like the Germans. Never mind. He's on a roll. Let him go.
Yeah, the Germans. was it over when the Germans bombed Pearl Harbor?
Yeah, right. And he's like, Germans? He goes, never mind. He's on a roll. Just let him go. That's it.
By the way, I have breaking entertainment. I have breaking entertainment news. I'm not making this up.
Yeah.
I don't,
okay. Go ahead.
See this? And this is an interesting story. You know, Hollywood people don't like a lot of the Hollywood people, but a story coming out of Hollywood right now. They're building a $1.8 billion Sony movie studio, and guess who it's backed by? Mark Wahlberg.
Oh wow.
Marky Mark, baby. Yeah, Marky Mark.
Is the Funky Bunch coming along too, or no?
No, they're deadbeats. He said, "Get out of here with the Funky Bunch." Now, his brother was in the Funky Bunch too, right?
This is very interesting because Mark Wahlberg has been very outspoken about things in Hollywood that he does not like,
and he's a religious guy, so they hate him about that too. But this is in the Las Vegas Review Journal. David O'Reilly, the CEO of Howard Hughes Holdings, poses for a photo at the site of the potential Sony Pictures studio and mixed-use development in Summerlin. That's in Vegas. That's not in L.A. So it's in the Summerlin neighborhood of Las Vegas. So that's where they're going to do it. A suburb of Vegas. You know what I'm saying?
I hear you, brother. I hear you.
Yeah, Mark Wahlberg. You got to talk about a guy who's got star power, man. He does. He's in so many movies. He keeps cranking them out.
He's in a lot of stuff.
Yep.
He's in some shit, but he's also been in some sucky movies too. But
come on.
But I'll tell you what. If you look at the beginning of that man's acting career, right?
Oh yeah.
If you look at you know, the evolution of Wahlberg as an actor goes from being nothing more than just like a punk off the streets of Southie, then to go into being a rapper, to being, you know, a Calvin Klein model, then starting to get into to acting. And, I mean, the guy's just gotten better every year. I mean, whether you like him or not, you got to give him credit in the fact
I love Mark Wahlberg.
As time's going on.
He seems like a genuine guy. He seems like the kind of guy, I've never met him, but he seems like the kind of guy you can sit down and have a beer with, and he's not going to, like, big time you. You know what I mean? He seems like a regular guy, and that's, you know, and this guy's got tons of money. I mean, Sony's committing $1.8 billion for this 50-acre production studio and mixed-use development in Summerlin could create 10,000 jobs in Las Vegas. And you know when you had 10,000 jobs, you know what we say, baby?
Vegas!
Oh, yeah, casino owners are going nuts right now thinking of all that revenue coming in. You kidding me?
Oh, yeah. Imagine being there tomorrow. Imagine being in Las Vegas this weekend, starting tomorrow. You want to talk about insane like it was during the Super Bowl? It's going to be even more insane.
Oh, no doubt.
They'll be in the books at 8 a.m. They'll be in the books at 8 a.m., 7 a.m., and they'll be in line all day at every single book in Las Vegas.
As well they should. And you know somebody like Wahlberg with the management team he's got around him, he's got a lot of smart people around him.
Absolutely.
And there's no way they're going to put that kind of investment into something that they think is going to potentially fail. That's not – because something like that could bankrupt you.
Absolutely.
And that's not going to happen. So that's good. That's good, though, man. It's creating jobs. That's awesome.
It's all about jobs, man. It's all about the jobs. Now, what's that noise? Are you smoking something?
Here.
Oh, is that Penny?
No. Penny's breathing over my shoulder. Come here, Penny girl.
Penny.
Penny comes to work with me.
Penny.
She comes to work with me on Wednesday.
Oh, beautiful. Where's Lily? Lily's not here. She usually is holding fort next to us, Robin. Where the hell did Lily go? We got the air conditioner off. The windows are open. And by the way, did you see the lot? The lot was shaved today. You went in and got a shave and a haircut. Our lot was shaved today. Did you see the overhead? The guy who's doing the dirt work, he actually has a drone, so he takes overhead shots so we don't have to drive out there every day to check it out, man. It's awesome. We got dirt.
Well,
not Joe Dirt. He may come out and help us in a couple of weeks. Yeah. Joe Dirt.
Yeah, right. Joe Dirt.
Now, are you doing any college basketball pools tonight? Are you getting action on the
– No. I'm out, dude. I didn't even do a bracket this year. I literally purged. I'm done. I took a step away from everything just to get a cleanse, you know? Sometimes you got to walk away from it just to kind of appreciate it again.
Now, what purge are we up to now? Because remember they had those purge movies and they had the first purge, the second purge, the last purge, the next to last purge.
Well, it wasn't the last purge. They just purged and they stopped making movies. That's what they did, Tom. They'll keep making them.
You paid
$17, you went to a movie theater and you sat there quietly. That's all you did.
They're doing another remake, because every day that's all they do in Hollywood now is remakes.
I know.
They're doing another version of The Never-Ending Story.
No.
That's what I saw today.
Really?
Yeah. How ridiculous is that, man? How ridiculous.
That thing goes on forever, dude. I don't know. It goes on forever, man.
Great. There was a great soundtrack, though, remember? It's a great soundtrack.
The Never-Ending Story is fine, but you know what my jam was? And Robin might appreciate this, because she's a little bit more European. The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe.
Yeah.
Although
I love that.
So I read all the books. I did not see all of the movies.
Well, excuse me. Fantastic.
Yeah, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe was awesome.
Yeah, I banged her in there. I mean, I had her. I had the witch.
So I take that back.
The Lion,
I
let him go.
I saw The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. It was on TV afterwards. I didn't see it in the theater. But when I saw it, I remember watching a bit of it, and they left out a whole bunch of stuff that was in the books, which makes me just lose interest. It's like, no, you left out really great shit.
Robin, that's what they do with movies.
Yeah, I don't like that.
Jesus.
Yeah, that's what Hustler magazine said.
Are you ready for baseball now, Luigi? I know you're a big baseball guy.
I am a big baseball guy.
Saw the Dodgers and the Padres playing in Seoul, South Korea, man. I'm telling you, man, Ohtani is going to be – forget about all these other players. Is there a bigger drawing card now in sports than Shohei Ohtani, even though he can't pitch and he's just going to, you know, play the field?
Tony, the only thing more popular in Korea than Shohei Ohtani is kimchi.
Well, exactly.
That's the only thing more popular than Shohei Ohtani.
What about sushi? No, what about sushi? Because remember, he's Japanese. He's Japanese.
Hi. Yes, he is Japanese.
Moshi Moshi.
Pat Morita, maybe? Respect? I don't know. Mr. Miyagi?
He's no longer with us, though, man.
That's what I said. Respect. All respect to
Robin, who's bigger than Shohei Ohtani?
Godzilla, number one.
Oh, Godzilla.
Godzilla's probably bigger.
Has there ever been a monster? I mean, there's a Frankenstein's and Dracula. Every year there's a new Godzilla movie. What the hell is going on out there?
Yeah, it's just a replay of my ex-girlfriend walking by a mirror. That's all it is, Johnny. Nothing more than that. You know who you are.
Yeah, I'm turning Japanese. I really think so. By the way, it's Wednesday, Robin, you know what that means. Publix, it's $5 sushi day.
Sushi!
But if we don't go as soon as the show's over, she's going to be left with is the stuff with the fake crab meat in it. What is that called?
$5 sushi, Tony. That seems fishy to me, pal. I don't know.
Oh.
I don't know, man. Sorry, it's bad. It's terrible. Oh, it's crab with a K, isn't it? The crab?
Yes. It's the fake crab California rolls. That's all there will
be. But they have real sushi, but the smart people get there early and clean it out.
Yeah.
Then if you go there after 6, you're left with the fake crab meat bullshit, man. And I don't play that.
Yeah, I
get my own crabs.
Even if I'm paying $5 for it, I can't have that. I need to have real crab, man.
No, but they have sushi.
No, they have
and they
real
have
sushi.
The sushi guys make it there.
Sushi.
And the one guy likes Robin at the Publix we goes to, and he keeps a couple in the back.
Yeah.
Because she knows he doesn't like it when Robin gets ugly. She'll bust that place up,
man. I got the hookup at the Acme Deli counter. Robin's got the hookup at the sushi counter at Publix, man.
Damn right, man. Dude. That's what it's all about.
Woo-hoo.
Luigi. All right,
I got to go set up, and I'll talk to you.
Now you're doing your trivia tonight.
Yeah, man. Tonight's quiz, Tony, is things that turn 30 in 2024.
Things that turn 30. I got a pair of underwear. Does that count?
Yeah, sure. Of course it does.
Beautiful, man. Luigi, great stuff, man. Be careful out there. Stay away from the subways. Don't sleep in the subway. And don't even go into the subway. In the meantime.
I'm sorry. I didn't have my fastball with me tonight, Tom, but I'm still working out a few things in spring.
That's all right, man. You always bring the intensity, the funk, the noise, the everything that you do. And we thank you for the great Luigi Curto. Tomorrow, more great stuff. We want to thank everybody for tuning in today, whether you're on No Filter, Facebook, Twitter Live, X Live. If you're listening on the apps anywhere in the world, we appreciate you being with us here every day from 3 to 6 Eastern Time. Tell your friends. Share the word. God bless America. It's still the most beautiful place on earth. Good night, everybody.
This knife has a straight edge on it, so it's very easy. And maybe in our world here, there lives a happy little mountain.
This knife has a straight edge on it, so it's very easy. Maybe in our world here, there lives a happy little mountain.
One real place for total sports. That's the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Hi. We're good to go.